University of Michigan football. Brought to you by Stroh Signature, the beer with something extra. By National Steel Corporation. National, driving for number one in quality, delivery, and price. And by Burger King. Aren't you hungry for a delicious flame-broiled juicy Whopper at Burger King now?
In this 10th week of the Big Ten football season involving the University of Michigan, tonight we are in Minneapolis at the Hubert H. Humphrey Metrodome. And tonight it's the University of Michigan Wolverines versus the Golden Gophers of the University of Minnesota. Hello, everybody. I'm Ray Lane, along with Jim Brandstetter. And Iowa and Ohio State have already won this afternoon. That means Michigan must win to occupy second place all by their lonesome.
Yeah, it is a big game. Minnesota's been down. They're not a very good football team. But it's a situation where Michigan's got Ohio State next week, a very big one. They can't come up flat against a young team in their last home game to an outgoing coach. I mean, they could be sticky. Michigan can't come out flat. They've got to come out and establish in order to keep Minnesota from coming up strong again.
Jim uses the word young team. And, of course, their quarterback, very young.
Brett Zadek is their quarterback. He's a freshman. You don't see many Big Ten teams going to freshman quarterbacks. But this youngster took over latter part of the season and has done an excellent job. He's got an outstanding arm, and he can be bothersome because Minnesota will throw the ball those short dump passes and they'll get yardage.
There have not been too many returning lettermen to the University of Minnesota, at least for 1983. However, they do have a pretty good offensive lineman.
On their two deeps, Ray, there are 18 freshmen playing for the Gophers, but number 53, Randy Rasmussen, an offensive guard, is truly one of the great stories of the Golden Gophers. He is one of the only players in the starting 22 on their two deeps that is actually a four-year player here at Minnesota. He came in as a freshman. He's been playing. The rest of them, well, they're freshmen, sophomores, juniors, some junior college kids, but Randy Rasmussen is one of those great kids who comes out and plays every week, and that's one of the things the Minnesota coaches have done. If there's one thing that Minnesota will do is they will come after you and play you very, very tough, even though they've had a terrible record.
And, of course, they do give up that big play every once in a while.
The defense is geared to gamble, and if they gamble, an offense can hit a running play up the middle, break a crease, and go right down the middle of the field for big, big yardage. Ohio State hit some big plays against them because the defense gambled.
Okay, don't go away. We'll have the opening kickoff in just one moment. University of Minnesota has won the toss of the coin and electing to receive, so the Golden Gophers defending the goal to the right and taking the kickoff of Michigan. Michigan in the traveling uniforms of those white jerseys and the maize hats, of course, on the left of your screens. And for Michigan, trying to chalk up its seventh win of conference play. You watch Todd Slopey get things all teed up and ready to go. Minnesota will send a couple of men deep around the goal line. And that will be Daryl Castile, number 19, and Dwayne Dutrell, number 45. Dutrell in the bottom half or at the top of your screen. And instead, taking a short kick is Nelson, number 34, Malcolm Nelson, and bringing it up across the 20-yard line, just about to the 24-yard line of Minnesota. So the Golden Gophers are going offense on that 15-yard return. The offensive line, of course, Rasmussen, the lone starter from a year ago in that offensive line for the Gophers. But pretty good receivers in there, and McMullen and Hartwig. But they throw a lot of short passes. Of course, they have lost their starting tight end, Jay Carroll, who is through for the season. And the young quarterback, Sadak, calling the signals in that pro set. Hand off to the fullback, Wilson. Wilson straight ahead. Might have got a yard up to the 25-yard line. And certainly the Wolverines know that Minnesota is not a real fancy team. As far as the Wolverines are concerned, DeFelice and Sunchitz are starting.
Kevin Brooks not in there. Dave Meredith getting the start up front instead of Brooks. And there you see the linebackers and defensive backs for the Wolverines.
The Wolverines are missing Tom Hassel, who did not make the trip up with a pulled hamstring. And hoping that he'll be available in that Ohio State game next Saturday at Ann Arbor. The pass out to Dwayne McMullen a little bit high, almost like he timed it a little bit early going up in the air. And it is incomplete. So it'll be now a second down, or rather third down and nine.
It's one of the passes that Minnesota will throw. They'll split McMullen out wide and drag him back underneath the linebackers. It's a little short pass, very safe to throw. Now Kevin Brooks back in the game defensively for Michigan, taking Dave Meredith's spot, who got the start.
And they use Dwayne McMullen, a flanker now, in the backfield with Wilson. The three wide receivers. And going out now to the fullback on the pass to Kevin Wilson. Wilson close to the first down. Boy, to Leon Pyle. Maybe a little bit shy. Reinhold and Anderson in there. Anderson, that is, and Mallory making the hit for Michigan.
They're putting McMullen, a flanker, in the backfield, Ray, and it looks like they're trying to isolate that running back, that quick guy McMullen, on a linebacker. Here you take a look at the play. Sadek gets a lot of protection, comes up in the pocket, and hits the pass, and that's just a little safety valve right out over the middle. Michigan's two linebackers reacting very quickly to it to prevent him from getting the first down.
Sophomore Adam Kelly only appearing in a second game. He's a walk-on. Fills a long punt to Cooper. Cooper takes it at his 19-yard line, comes up the middle, fights for a little extra ground, and gets across the 30-yard line. Pretty good kick there by Adam Kelly, young man out of Excelsior, Minnesota. And a 49-yard punt by Adam Kelly, only his fifth of the year. So Michigan going on offense for the first time in this ball game. And, of course, some familiar names for the maize and blue in that offensive unit. First and 10 at the 31 at the Michigan 31. Our ball game just underway with 13 minutes and 24 seconds to go. Illinois, Ohio State, and Iowa all winning this afternoon. Wisconsin getting by Purdue. So those are the four winners in the Big Ten action. Fake to the fullback, a low pitch out to Rogers. Fumble, and Minnesota recovery at the Michigan 23-yard line. A little pitch coming from Steve Smith out to Rogers, a little bit low and behind Rogers. Had to go down to get it. Good hang on.
Exactly, Ray. The option play is there. Smith, of course, he pitches it low behind him. Now, Rick Rogers should just cup this ball in there. There's no reason that should have gotten away from him. He had it into his chest. But that mistake is the kind of thing Michigan cannot afford in games like this. Even though Minnesota is as bad as they are on their record, you give them opportunities, and they can come up and be sticky.
Of course, Minnesota with only one win against eight losses overall this year. That lone win was the first game of the year when they knocked off Rice 21-17. Pitch this time now going to the tailback, and that is Malcolm Nelson. And Nelson finding some pretty good running room over there on the right side. Cinchich makes the tackle. And getting close to the 15, they mark it back now to the 16-yard line of Michigan. Talking about Malcolm Nelson, and here is a team of the Gophers with a lot of injuries this year. And coming in this ballgame, averaging just about 4.1 per carry. Only carried 22 times, however. He's carried a couple times tonight. Second down at about four. Nelson trying to get outside. He eluded one would-be tackler. And that looked as if it was DeFelice who had a shot at him and couldn't bring him down. And so then Nelson picks up a couple of yards and will go to third down and maybe 2 yards to go. Finally, it was Carlton Rose along with Cockley. Well, Joe Salem, who's already announced that he'll be departing at the end of the season. So Joe's saying so long. This is the final home game for the Gophers here in Minneapolis. And they'll finish up on the road next week at Iowa. Third down and two for the Gophers. Nelson on the carry, straight ahead, goes ahead and has the first down. That one is close to the 10-yard line of Michigan. Nelson doing some strong running that time.
But more importantly, Ray, what they're doing is getting some blocking at the point of attack, giving the ball to Nelson deep in the backfield, and he's able to pick his own hole. Now, there was a hole there, and that is why Nelson was able to get the first down yardage. Good blocking by those people up front, led by Randy Rasmussen.
Kevin Brooks, who did not start this ball game, is in there now. First and 10 at the 11-yard line. And swarmed under for a loss As Sadek moving out to his left, trying to find somebody and leading the way for Michigan on the defense. Again, it was Al Cincich.
Cincich came in there, but one of the reasons he came free was the fact that Michigan came with a blitz. He comes right over the guard spot and follows him in there, but the guards were getting over there to block Mallory coming on a blitz. Cincich just beat the guard that pulled out in front of him.
Nelson and Wilson stay in there as the running backs. Wilson, Kevin Wilson, the fullback. And Wilson on the carry. Gant had a shot at him up on top, trying to tackle a little bit high. And down below was Anderson, Tim Anderson, making the tackle.
You got to give Minnesota a lot of credit. They have three of their key backs, the quarterback, fullback, and tailback, all three are freshmen. And so far in this big game against a very good Michigan team, they're looking poised, and they're doing a good job running the football.
Right now, the Golden Gophers face with a third down situation, third and 11. And the Gophers coming this ball game on third down efficiency for the season at 33%. Need 11 yards for the first down. One-on-one situation into the corner, and Lott over there covering his man. Feet getting a little bit mixed up. But no flag goes down. That was intended for McMullen. And Lott was covering him like a blanket.
Yeah, and I think one of the reasons the flag didn't go down was that ball was not catchable. If that ball would have come down and hit McMullen on the helmet or gotten in there, I think maybe the referee might have thrown the flag. But Sadek is getting a big rush here from Rodney Lyles. He throws this way out and out of bounds, and I think the referee rules that that ball was not catchable. That's why the flag was not there, because it was very close to being an interference call, Rick.
Senior Jim Galloway has checked in, and he'll try for the field goal. He'll be 29 yards out, a 29-yard attempt. Ball will be marked at the 19-yard line. And Galloway has put the Golden Gophers on the board with that 29-yard effort. And for Galloway, his 10th field goal of the year. So with 10:08 to go in the first quarter, the Golden Gophers on top by three. So the Michigan turnover, costly to the Wolverines, as the Wolverines defense settles for giving up 3 points to this young man, Jim Galloway, who will handle the kickoff duties. You know, you look back to Minnesota's losses this year, and they have been lopsided at least four of those games. Nebraska knocked them off 84-13, OSU, Ohio State 69-18, Wisconsin 56-17, and Illinois 50-23. Going way back was Kerry Smith that time, and the end zone could not handle it on the kick from Galloway, so it'll be Michigan bringing the ball out to the Wolverine 20-yard line.
Ray, so, in each of those blowouts you were talking about, Minnesota did well in their first couple series. They did well defensively. They did well offensively, and then things got away from them as the other team came up with the big plays. This game right now, we've seen Minnesota come out and force a turnover. Michigan has got to get back in this game, get their heads maybe back in the game more than anything.
Garrett and Rogers are the running backs, and the handoff is to Rogers. Goes against the grain once he took the handoff. Got across the 25-yard line, close to the 27, brought down by the free safety, Andy Hare.
You know, one of the things about Minnesota is that their second-leading tackler is Kerry Glenn, who is one of their secondary people. And that shows you the kind of defense they run. They will gamble, but when you gamble, a lot of teams will get into your secondary and you have a lot of room to run. When your safety is your second-leading tackler, you've been hurt.
Second and three. Garrett got the call. The fullback is dropped for a loss as Joe Christopherson, the middle linebacker, comes in there. And believe it or not, that is the first time that a fullback from Michigan has been thrown for a loss this year.
And again, the gambling defense. Christopherson coming in a blitz situation, gambling on second down and five, and it worked. They caught Michigan in the backfield with the fullback. Now, a lot of times when they'll gamble like that and the offense guesses right, then the big play hurts you.
All right, a loss of a yard. Third down and four. They move Rogers way out to the right on a spread formation. One running back there. That's the fullback. Smith going to go to the air for the first time over the middle. And off the hands of Sim Nelson. And then Mark Ray had the ball. They're going to rule it, I believe, incomplete. Minnesota wanted to fumble on that. So maybe Michigan gets a break after all. We'll wait and see. Well, they say what? Completion? And that he was down.
The ball apparently came off Sim Nelson and then Trando Marcre running a crossing pattern behind, had possession, and apparently the referee ruled his knee was down. Take a look. There's the tip. Here comes Marcre. Has possession, knees down, the ground caused the fumble. That is the way the referee ruled. Michigan gets a big break, first down.
And here at the Metrodome, the Golden Gopher fans not too happy with the call. At the 37, handoff to Rogers. He gets to the 40-yard line. And in there to make a stop on him. The fellow that we were talking about a little bit earlier, Deuce Bobek and Joe Christopherson. Christopherson, that is.
Minnesota gambling on defense, Ray, and you can see it. They're sending a lot of people at the line of scrimmage. They will blitz a lot. And Michigan is about two steps away, it appeared, on a couple of plays of breaking a big one. A lot of man-to-man, one-on-one coverage in their secondary.
Second down and eight. And Smith this time fires over the middle. He's complete to, I want to say, Nelson. And it is Nelson. Is tight end. It gets into Gopher territory at the 49.
Well, once again, you'll see the blitz coming. Smith is looking at two people coming from the outside. Got to get rid of the ball quickly. But when you blitz, you have one-on-one man coverage on your receivers. That's how Nelson got open so quickly. He was had single coverage and was able to beat that coverage and allow Smith to throw the ball quickly.
First down for Michigan for Nelson, his 29th reception of the year, and he is the leading pass receiver for the Wolverines so far the season. Vince Bean running next with a total of 24. Going to go to the air again and try on a deep pattern. Firing just over the head of Vince Bean. He had a couple of the men beaten. He had Hare beaten, and he had also Kerry Glenn.
That time Minnesota stayed back, didn't gamble with a blitz, and were in a zone defense. Vincent Bean split the zone, but Steve threw the ball a little bit too far on the post cut, even though it was open.
So Steve Smith now 2 for 3 in the passing department. Second down and 10, still at the 49-yard line of the Golden Gophers. If you just joined us, 7 minutes and 19 seconds to go in the first quarter. And the Gophers on top by a score of 3-0, thanks to a 29-yard field goal by Gallery. Rogers trying to get outside, and he is tripped up as Deuce Bobek, the outside linebacker, and usually you see him working on the weak side, comes through to make the stop.
Michigan is looks like they're trying to punch things outside. One of the things that is happening is Minnesota's linebackers are playing very tough outside. Deuce Bobek on one side, Tessier on the other side. They're both good outside linebackers, very active, and you're going to have a better play fake inside to get those guys committing back inside so you can break one outside.
Here's Bobek, of course, only a freshman. Tessier, only a sophomore. So down the road, the Gophers are looking at some pretty good linebackers. Smith with plenty of time, knocked away, intended that time for the fullback, Garrett. And a guy that came in there was Grafunder, and he's thinking now, I could have had an interception. Big defensive play.
And if he would have had the interception, he'd have gone the entire length of the field for a Minnesota touchdown because there was absolutely nobody out there. Minnesota guessed right defensively that time. They did not blitz. They were in zone coverage, and nobody was open. So Smith went to the checkoff pass to the fullback, and Grafunder was right in the way, almost made the big, big play.
Bracken back for the first punt of the evening. Line of scrimmage at the Minnesota 49-yard line. Pressure and block as Minnesota sent six men in. Recovered by Michigan, but right at the line of scrimmage. Big play again for Minnesota as the Golden Gophers will have great field position at their own 49-yard line.
Well, you can't blame Bracken totally on that. The ball bounced back to him, Ray.
Well, we got a timeout, and it's still Minnesota on top by 3. They credit Greg Mulligan, backup linebacker on that block punt by Minnesota. Little razzle-dazzle now. Give and go by Minnesota and intercepted by Michigan. Cochran stepping in to haul it in. Intended that time for the split end, Hartwick. As the quarterback finally got the ball back, Sadek then went to a split end, racing down the left sideline to no avail.
Earlier this afternoon, Nebraska ran this play and threw the ball out of bounds. Here, Brad Cochran does a great job, does not take the fake inside on the run, stays right with Hartwig, the wide receiver, and does a great job on the interception. Good defensive position and a good, smart, heady defensive play by Michigan's cornerback out of Brother Rice High School.
6 minutes and 16 seconds left in the opening quarter with Minnesota on top, 3-0. Michigan deep in its own territory at the 11-yard line, the Wolverines 11. So they got some churning to do, worth about 89 yards. They get down to try to get that touchdown. Rogers getting some good blocking and tripped up, however, by the linebacker. Doing a pretty good job, and that was Tessier who came through and just tripped him up.
It looked to me like he tripped over Doug James' legs. Doug James had a block going, and there was room outside. And Rick Rogers just did not pick up his feet and get out through that hole and get to the open area.
Got a yard on the carry. They're going to say 2 yards, so make it second down and a long 8. Wide receivers on the left side, and Bean and Mark Ray. And passing to Steve Smith, rolling out of the pocket. And this one is intended for Bean. Just about the time the ball arrived on a say, a good play that time by Dutrell, who came in there and sort of just made contact, and there was no chance for Bean to make the play.
Came out with a play-action fake on a rollout, and I think one of the reasons Bo Schembechler did that was to negate the blitz, to negate the heavy pressure that Minnesota has been putting on them. And he got a good block on the corner. Steve had a lot of time. He is rolling to his left and throwing for a right-handed quarterback is tough that way, and he just missed through the ball behind Vince Bean.
Smith now 2 of 5. He completed his first two passes, now 0 for 3. Trying for his sixth one right now, getting extra time. Fires it into a crowd there to Bean, and Bean makes a reception close to the 25-yard line. Takes a little extra effort on the quarterback's part and also the wide receiver to make that play.
Not only that, but check the blocking up front. They're coming with 6 people, and they do a good job holding them out. Smith looks off his primary receiver, sees Vince Bean coming over with 2 people on him, and drills the ball in there. Give the offensive line credit for holding them out and allowing Smith to come off the primary receiver and hit Bean dragging across the middle.
Third first down now by Michigan, all coming on the way of the pass, the aerial. And Minnesota faking a blitz that time, a long count. And on the option play, Smith comes up the middle, cracks it open, could go all the way, down to the 35. 20, touchdown Michigan. Checking for flags, not on the field, close to a clipping play, back of the 20. But no flags are down, and Smith goes for the touchdown.
That's the kind of thing we talked about before the game. You can crack a big play because they gamble. Watch. They're coming with a blitz on the outside. The inside linebacker gets caught up inside. Smith is now by everybody, including the safeties. Now all he has to outrun is Kerry Glenn. Smith has 4-6 speed and is able to go the distance. Outstanding play, but they caught Minnesota in that gambling defense. Cracked the crease and went the distance.
So Michigan's Steve Smith has the longest play from scrimmage this season with that touchdown gallop of 75 yards. Bergeron for the extra point. He has it, and a flag has gone down. Michigan on top for the first time in this ball game with 4 minutes and 51 seconds to go in the opening quarter. The officials have not indicated it may be against Minnesota. We may see the 5-yard penalty coming back on a kickoff. We'll wait and see. Glenn Fortin is the referee in tonight's ball game. Offside Minnesota. The extra point is good, and we'll take a look at that penalty right after we have this timeout. Well, the penalty has been assessed now against the Golden Gophers and will be assessed here on a kickoff, so Schlope will move the tee to the 45-yard line. Michigan leading by a score of 7-3, and what a run by Smith of 75 yards to get the Wolverines out on top. Dutrell along with Castile, and Castile going right back to the end line and stepping out, automatic touchback, and Minnesota to bring the ball out to the 20-yard line. Up to this point, there have been a couple of gallops this year worth around 52 yards for the Wolverines, but Steve Smith now with the longest play from the line of scrimmage this year.
Now, that's the history of Minnesota this year. They have given up the big play against Ohio State, Ray. I know this sounds amazing, but Minnesota offensively ran a total of 93 plays. And yet Minnesota was blown out of the game by Ohio State. The reason? Ohio State to take a minute and 15 like Michigan to go the distance and only use three plays.
And all of a sudden, you're the other team, Minnesota in this case, marching down the field, getting some position, but taking about 8-9 minutes at a crack, right?
Exactly.
That one intended for the flanker, Dwayne McMullen, and it's incomplete. So it'll be 2nd and 10 at the Minnesota 20-yard line.
Michigan gambling a little bit themselves on defense with the blitz. And we see again some more defensive linemen in there as Bo shuttles defensive linemen in there to keep them fresh so that they can put pressure on Sadek. Mike Hammerstein is in the game along with Brooks, and at the middle guard is Nate Rogers.
So you talk about pass rush, you think pass rush with those three guys up front. Sadek now 1 for 4 in the passing department. Pitch out now going to the tailback, Malcolm Nelson. And Nelson cuts it up pretty good after he got to the 25-yard line. He paid for it as Cochran came in there and Cooper and really drilled him right at the 25, a 5-yard gain.
One of the things that Minnesota can do when they have Michigan looking for pass is to hit him with a run like they just did. Michigan is committing some linebackers in there, trying to get some pressure on Sadek. And if you can get the running plays going, you keep the defense off balance.
Darryl Castile checks in now. He's wide on the left side out of your picture. And that is Hartwig at the top of the screen there, the wide receiver. Over the middle and complete this time to Clark Johnson. Nope, they say he did not have it. It is incomplete just about at the line of scrimmage coming across.
And Rich Hewlett was covering, and Rich Hewlett was the nickelback. So Michigan defensively doing a good job. See Hewlett? He comes across. He's got that motion man in one-on-one, and he is right there on him when the pass arrives. That is a good defensive call by the Michigan defensive coaches to get that nickel back in there so that when he came in motion, they'd have a fast guy on a fast guy, and it eliminated an isolated situation where a back is isolated on a linebacker.
Well, Minnesota wanted to go to the punt formation, but they found they only had, I believe, 10 players on the field, so they had to call for a timeout. That is number 80 back there, Adam Kelly. He was ready for the snap. All of a sudden, one of the outside men had counted and realized there were only 10 troops out there.
Take this opportunity to to wish my mother and father a very happy 45th wedding anniversary back in East Lansing. They're celebrating at the University Club. And for everybody in my family that's watching the game, I will be back Sunday morning, and we will have a brunch celebration, even though I can't be there tonight.
Well, congratulations to the Brandstetters, of course, and just like an old general once said, I shall return, right, Jim?
Exactly. My dad would like that, seeing as how he is a retired brigadier general.
Well, we'd like to also send a special greeting to a gentleman that I've known a long time and a real Michigan backer, Al Kinnerson, back in the Detroit area, and some of the members of the Meadowbrook Country Club out of Northville on hand for this ball game here at the Metrodome tonight. So Minnesota facing a 4th and 5 with 4 minutes and 35 seconds to go. And, of course, we'll be looking for all you Michigan fans come next Saturday afternoon at Ann Arbor as the Buckeyes of Ohio State move in. The finale of the regular season.
And a big one because there's a major bowl bid riding on that game.
Adam Kelly back in punt formation. Cooper standing for Michigan around his own 35-yard line. Kelly got off a 49-yard punt on his first effort. Backing up at the 33 is Cooper. Up to the 40, close to the 45-yard line. Nice run back by Cooper. Cooper coming in this ballgame, 2nd in the Big Ten in punt returns. And with that kind of an effort on that last one, he'll stay right there. Or maybe even move closer to the top. Of course, Garcia Lane of Ohio State is a top punt returner in the Big Ten.
Michigan is looking to make some big plays with their special teams and kick teams in this game also. They feel like last week against Purdue that they can do some things against Minnesota in the kicking game.
Well, a 12-yard return that time by Cooper. He's had it back for 7 and for 12 so far tonight on punts by Minnesota of 49 and 41. 1st and 10, Michigan at the 45-yard line. The Wolverine 45. Rick Rogers on the outside. Gets close to 4 yards. And coming up a little bit from the secondary was Kevin Taylor, a young man out of Detroit Southwestern High School, playing a cornerback position, number 47 for Minnesota, to make the stop on Rogers.
Minnesota doing a good job defensively when they don't gamble, when they stay in that 4-3 look. When they gamble and commit inside linebackers and blitz, they get hurt. And you wonder sometimes, why they do that. But they have all season, and I don't think they're going to change their defense. Right now, their linebackers are faking up inside with the blitz.
Boy, they had all three of them up in that line. Now they back off a little bit. Pitch out to Rogers on a 2nd and 7. Turns the corner, has the first down, and run out of bounds at the 40-yard line thanks to Kerry Glenn, a junior out of St. Louis, East St. Louis, Illinois.
Good job by Michigan blocking on the corner, and also good block by the fullback. He comes out and kicks the last man on the line of scrimmage out. Watch, 32, gets the block, kicks him out. Rogers cuts back inside and then gets outside to turn the corner before Glenn comes over and knocks him out of bounds.
So Rogers going that time.
Eddie Garrett, the fullback, with the block on the corner there, Ray.
Rice, of course, the other fullback, one of the other fullbacks, having a problem with the neck and not expected to see action this ball game for Michigan. Garrett, quick opening play and driving, getting those legs churning across the 35-yard line. The Gophers on pile. He should be close to the 34. Oh, he was moving pretty good. They'll set it down at the 34-yard line.
Not only that, but Michigan has taken control up front. Look at the offensive line and look at the hole there in between Humphreys and DiOrio, Tom Dixon in on the linebacker. Those are the kinds of things that you like to see your offensive line do. Create big holes inside, then you force the team to gamble. Now Minnesota may be forced into gambling, and when they gamble, you can hit the big play.
Garrett got 6 yards on that carry, so it's 2nd down and 4. And here goes Rogers to work, has the first down, close to the 25-yard line, and covered up that time by Kerry Glenn, the strong side safety.
Another big block at the point of attack by Eddie Garrett, the fullback, as he took on Tessier. Watch 32. It will be one-on-one. Bang. There's the block. Rogers cuts off it, gets through. Tessier does a good job of actually holding on, but I'll tell you what, Eddie Garrett and he met helmets, and it was a standoff. That's a good, tough, hard-nosed block by the fullback.
Jim wanted to say it was a frightful thing to watch. At the 26-yard line, 1st and 10 for Michigan. And again, we'll repeat what Bo has said all year long with Garrett and Rice and Armstrong at that fullback position. A great tandem of blockers, maybe the best he's ever had. Inside the 25, close to the 24-yard line on the carry that time by Rick Rogers.
Eddie Garrett and Deuce Bebek and Tessier are going to have a long evening because it looks like Michigan is going with that fullback blocking on that outside linebacker, the end man on the line of scrimmage, and they're cutting the tailback block off of that. And in the last 3 situations we've seen, it has been one-on-one with the fullback and the outside backer.
Oh, you saw Jerry DiOrio check out of there. He was over there talking with Bolt and the assistant. Art Lourdes in there now at the guard position on the left side. Here comes Rogers again. But Rogers stopped that time by the linebacker moving up, and that's the fellow that Jim was talking about, Deuce Bebek, number 59, 6'3", 195-pounder.
And that time, Eddie Garrett missed the block on Deuce Bebek. He was after him again, but Deuce Bebek slipped inside the block and made the tackle.
They have the ball marked at the 22-yard line. And so 3rd down and about 6 yards for Michigan. We're down to 1 minute and 19 seconds remaining in the first quarter, and Michigan leading in this ball game by a score of 7-3. Spotted Minnesota, 3 points on a field goal, then came back on a 75-yard run by Steve Smith, plus the extra point. 3rd and 6, Smith over the middle, in and out of the hands of Vince B. He had him open, close to a 1st down had he been able to hang on to it.
Minnesota came with the blitz, again, gambling. Watch the linebackers, they're coming. Here comes Christopherson, middle linebacker. He's almost free, but that's one-on-one coverage now with Vince Bean. And you saw Sutton didn't have coverage, but Vincent couldn't hold the football.
Well, a season mark of field goals could be tied right now on this effort by Bob Bergeron. He is shooting for his 12th field goal of the year. And you'll remember a year ago was Ali Haji Sheik, who had 12 in one season. So Bob Bergeron could tie that mark. Right now with this 39-yard effort, the ball will be spotted at the 29. Kick is up, has the distance, and the kick is good. So with 58 seconds to go in the first quarter, Bergeron adds 3 more points on the scoreboard for Michigan, and the Wolverines leading now by a score of 10-3.
Give the Minnesota defense some credit there, Ray, in the sense that They had Michigan on a drive. Michigan was doing very, very well running the football off tackle. They gambled on two or three occasions and made the big plays. Agreed. Vincent Bean dropped the pass that helped because they could have had a first down on the blitz when Steve Smith caught him in it, but Vince didn't hold on to the football. So Michigan really didn't capitalize on the big play opportunities they had that Minnesota gave them because they came with that blitzes, and their receivers were covered by one man.
Bob Bergeron coming in this ball game second in kick scoring in the Big Ten and third overall in the scoring department. So Bob has chalked up four points so far tonight. Michigan going in eight plays, a total of 23 yards, and taking just about 4 minutes on the clock and capping it off with that field goal effort of 39 yards by Bergeron. So Slopey all set to kick off. And back is Dwayne Dutrell and Daryl Castile. Castile again deep in his own end zone, has no opportunity to run it out, and once again Minnesota will take the touchback and bring it out to the Gopher 20-yard line. Down to 58 seconds remaining in this first quarter.
And you talk about the importance of the kicking game. Todd Schlope kicking the ball into the end zone, forcing Minnesota to go 80 yards to score with their kind of offense, which is the short dump pass. It's a very difficult job for them to go the distance, to go the long way, because you've got to throw a lot of those passes, and the defense is designed at Michigan in a situation like that to bend and not break and force the mistake.
Nelson and Wilson, the running backs, and behind Sadek, the quarterback for Minnesota. Nelson taking that little pitch and going straight ahead for a couple of yards. That's about it. Nothing fancy. The other day, Jim and I watching films of this Minnesota ball club, primarily against the Ohio State team, and we saw mostly on the runs were draw plays against the Ohio State defense.
They ran draw plays and screen passes, a lot of those too. That was really the primary offense as far as their running game was concerned, was the draw play. We have seen, it looks like a pitch sweep and a pitch power off tackle.
3 yards on that carry by Nelson, so make it second down and seven with 22 seconds to go here in the first quarter. Wilson, a fullback, taking the handoff and getting close to the 24-yard line. Might have got a yard on the carry, and again, Tim Anderson, interior linebacker, making the hit. 7 seconds, we may have seen our last play of the first quarter, as he'll not have enough time to get another one going. That is the end of the first quarter, with Michigan on top by a score of 10-3 over the Golden Gophers of Minnesota. All set to start the second quarter. It'll be third down and six for Minnesota. The busiest man in the backfield, of course, a rushing game for Minnesota has been Nelson. He's carried six times for a total of 24 yards. And if you're wondering about Michigan's ground attack, of course, it's been Rogers, the tailback, who's carried 10 times for a total of 35 yards. But the big play of this ball game has been the 75-yard jump by quarterback Steve Smith for the touchdown in the first quarter. Third down and six for the Gophers. Passing situation for Sadek. Looking for the man over the middle, and a little mix-up that time, as a flanker, Dwayne McMillan, came over the top. He also had Hartwick coming over there. And I was watching McMillan. He just pulled up short and almost stopped on the pattern.
Well, the ball was tipped at the line of scrimmage, Ray, and it was deflected more down the field. The reason the receiver stopped was he saw the middle was all clogged up. Michigan had anticipated that play.
Here's Adam Kelly, and there is Cooper of Michigan. He is standing at his own 36-yard line. Kelly, number 80, with a punt of 49 and 41. End over end this time, and gets a Michigan bounce at the 45 and flicked right around the 45-yard line. So the Wolverines with good field position at their own 45-yard line. That punt, a little bit on the short side, only 31 yards. Adam Kelly has taken over the punting department for a fellow by the name of Paul Blanchard. That's quite a story with the young Mr. Blanchard, who is a senior, and he is the son of a former baseball star, Johnny Blanchard, of the New York Yankees. He's been the regular punter for three seasons here. This past April, they found out that young Mr. Blanchard had Hodgkin's disease. He said he'd be back this fall, and he was back for the first nine ball games and gave way last week to the sophomore, Adam Kelly. And we certainly wish the best for Paul Blanchard.
You know, Minnesota is full of a lot of stories like that. We talked at the top of the show about Randy Rasmussen and the job he's done
under very difficult circumstances for him, because last year he was the second team All-Big Ten selection. This year they figured he'll get some All-America mention. And when you're with a team that has given up so many points, as we see Michigan declining the penalty that was called on Minnesota, when you give up so many points and you're in a situation where you're losing big so many times during this season, it's tough to keep your heads up. But one thing that Minnesota has done, and we saw it in the films that we were watching earlier this week with Alex Agassi, is they have not given up. Everyone out there comes after you. They will play hard, tough football. But they just are on the wrong end of the score this season, and they're on the wrong end big.
Well, 12 seniors say goodbye to the home crowd tonight here for Minnesota, as well as the head coach, Joe Salem, who has announced his resignation. Michigan has first and 10 at the 45-yard line. A little mix-up that time, and the whistle sound. And Michigan forced to call a timeout.
I'll tell you, this is the kind of thing that really upsets Bo Schembechler. These are mental mistakes, and he just does not want to put up with those.
Okay, while Bo talks it over with Smith, let's listen to this message. Well, Michigan football at night, under the lights here at the Humphrey Metrodome in Minneapolis. They were expecting around 41,000 fans here tonight. It looks like if they're going to be a little bit on the light side of that hope as far as the number of fans. Here's Rogers, line of scrimmage at the 45, and boy, he just keeps driving and driving. Might have got 7 yards, and does get 7 yards on the carry to the 48-yard line of Minnesota.
Well, that's the best run that Rick Rogers has made all night long. Take a look. He sees the hole, breaks inside. Now, when he gets into traffic, he just keeps his legs running, and he just keeps after him, and he gets as many yards as he can. And earlier in the game, we saw him tripping over hands, and we saw him not running through tackles. That was his best run of the night, in the sense that he's running a lot harder, it appears.
A little push from behind by one of the Gophers didn't hurt either for a couple of yards. Second down and three for Michigan. Garrett remaining in there at fullback in front of Rogers. And we get a whistle just about the time the ball is ready to be snapped. And we may get delay of game here. Yep. Delay of game against the Wolverines. And so with the timeout and this penalty for the delay of game, again, Jim, going back to what you said, and you're looking ahead, you got to get through this ball game, of course, but when you're going against a foe like Ohio State, you don't want to be taking those costly penalties or calling the unnecessary timeouts.
Exactly. And right now, I would venture to say, and I don't think anybody would disagree with me, that the Michigan football team, at least offensively, is not mentally sharp tonight. They're getting the job done. They're at 10-3, but they're not mentally sharp.
So with the penalty now, it'll make it second down and around 8 yards. Mark Ray and Bean are the wide receivers. Mark Ray makes a pass, breaks the tackle, got the good speed, could go all the way, and will go all the way. Check for the flags. No flags down, and Michigan scores on the pass to Mark Ray.
Well, again, Michigan caught Minnesota coming with a blitz from the outside. Smith gets in there. They're blitzing. There is one-on-one coverage in the secondary. Mark Ray breaks one tackle by Sutton. Now he's off to the races. In a zone, the safety man would be over to help out on that play. When you're coming with an all-out blitz and you hit a receiver, if the man covering doesn't make the tackle, you're looking at trouble. And Mark Ray got into the end zone because of that.
And Mark Ray, for the second successive week now, goes across that goal line with his second touchdown reception of the year. Here's Bergeron, and he is perfection again with that extra point. So Bergeron with a field goal and a couple of extra points tonight. And Michigan increasing the lead now by a score of 17-3 over Minnesota. Well, all Steve Smith has done tonight is run for a touchdown of 75 yards and then goes to the air and hurls his sixth touchdown pass of the season. And again, as you were with us when we began our telecast tonight on a kick by Schlope, and off the shoulder pads that time of number 45, Dutrell, he likes not to run it on. He had a break there instead of that ball bouncing off his pads and coming back out into the field of play. What I started to say is that for Michigan, they've been able to come up with a couple of big plays, and again, Minnesota doing a little expensive gambling.
Exactly. When you come with a blitz and you do a lot of single coverage or man-man coverage, if you hit a pass and the defensive back that is on the single coverage misses a tackle, you're looking at giving up a big big play. And in that instance, when Markwright beat the tackle by Sutton, that's what it cost him, a big play and a touchdown.
Well, Minnesota at the line of scrimmage at its own 20-yard line, first and 10. This time, it's the quarterback on a keeper, Sadek. I don't know whether that was called for or whether it was a broken play. Think it was a broken play?
Yeah, the ball popped free. It looked like he never got the center quarterback exchange, and it popped up about right in front of his face. He grabbed it and turned upfield. He had nowhere else to go because the backs were already into their roots, and he had no way to hand the ball off, so he just took it and made as much as he could out of it.
A week ago against Illinois, Sadek injured his left shoulder, and he was able to come back in to start this ball game. He's only a freshman out of Rosemark, Minnesota. Nelson coming straight ahead on a second down and 8. Got to the line of scrimmage and Mike got a yard, and he was greeted by Carlton Rose, sort of stood him up there a little bit.
Coming from the outside in a blitz, Michigan gambling now. You'll take a look at the right-hand side of your screen. Carlton Rose just comes right flying over the top. He was lined up as the original man on the line of scrimmage out with the wide receiver.
And that was Tony Hunter, number 33, on that carry. So Hunter had checked in there at the tailback position. He's playing with a pretty sore hamstring, and that's really not at full speed. So Tony Hunter, number 33, in the lineup for Minnesota. And look out. Sadek is greeted that time. Cooper on a blitz as he broke in from a strong side safety and does the damage. And sack-wise for Cooper, number 2 for the year.
That's number 31, Kevin Wilson. He is the blocking back, and Evan Cooper runs right by him. Nobody touches Cooper as Michigan comes with their safety blitz, and Minnesota pays.
Pushing the Gophers back to the 14-yard line. And that will send their punter, Adam Kelly, back to his goal line. Cooper, meanwhile, will wait around his 43 for this punt coming up. With 11 minutes and 40 seconds to go in the first half, Michigan in command, almost blocked. Got it away. Cooper at the 48 of Michigan. Straight ahead. Big play. 25, 23-yard line, maybe the 22. Boy, a lot of daylight once he got by the first couple of defenders of Minnesota. Broke it up the middle to the 22-yard line and finally brought down by Weipert.
Evan Cooper does a good job here of getting through the first wave. Right there, that cut gets him through. Now he uses his speed up the middle, makes a cut here back to his left. And if he had made it a little bit sharper, Gant, who was right in front of him, could have blocked that tackler Weipert, probably gotten Cooper into the end zone.
Well, Kelly kicks it for a total of 37 yards, and Mr. Cooper brings it back for a total of 29. So Michigan knocking on the door again at the 22-yard line of Minnesota. First and 10. Rogers. Good blocking. Tried to slip outside and just barely got inside the 20. They'll mark it at the 20-yard line. So he gets about 3 yards on that carry.
Michigan running into the sideline to the tight end side. Last week, you remember, Bo Schembechler decided he would go to the weak side or the split end side against Purdue because the Boilermakers overshifted to the tight end. This week, Minnesota is playing it a little bit more straight up, so he's running to the tight end when the situation warrants.
And you're taking a look at Bo Schembechler, of course, trying to chalk up his 104th win in Big Ten Conference play overall, his 139th win at the University of Michigan. Smith firing behind Mark Ray that time. He was covered by Phil Sutton at the 10-yard line.
Same pattern they scored on, but this time Steve Smith threw the ball a little bit behind Mark Ray.
So the box will turn over to down number 3. And it's still third down and 7 yards for Michigan at the 20-yard line of the Golden Gophers.
This is a down, Ray, where Minnesota now is in a position where they say to themselves, we have been hurt by the big play because of the blitz before in this game. Should we come after them, or should we play this layback defense and have Michigan make the play to beat us?
Man-to-man on two wideouts on the right side, and that's Mark Ray and Bean. And instead, the running play by Steve Smith, who carried and goes all the way. I think the Gophers are smelling pass that time, and Smith crossing up the opposition and going in for his second touchdown on the ground.
Now, they went outside with the option play. Here it is, and you get a great look at it. Down the line of scrimmage. Now, look at everybody flowing out there. Smith cuts it back inside. Good block by Doug James. Then there's the great cut that Tessier ran right by him. Now Smith goes into the end zone nearly untouched because Minnesota was flowing so much to the option of the tailback that Smith was able to cut it back against the grain and have a lot of room.
Smith this time on a 23-yard gallop. You'll check out the kick now by Bergeron. Contact made that time. Minnesota's man breaking in there and making contact. Well, the Gophers a little bit upset. And it's been a frustrating season, as Jim has told you. Norris Wilson also was in there to come across that offensive line of Michigan. So wait the call now from Glenn Fortin. Offside Minnesota. Not too much doubt about that. We're just waiting to see if there's any movement or motion by Michigan.
Well, one of the things about the offense in a kick situation like this, Michigan's offensive line goes down with their hands on their knees. They do not go down into a three-point stance. When you are in a two-point stance, there is movement allowed. But if you are in a three-point stance and you move, then that is deemed illegal procedure. When you're in a two-point stance and you move one way or the other, you can't make a move toward the line of scrimmage like you're going to go out and block somebody. But incidental movement like that from a two-point stance is not considered illegal procedure. And the defense, when they react to it, gets the penalty.
Ball Zecker waiting for the snap from center. Bergeron waiting for that ball to be placed down. It is. The kick is up, and the kick is good. So 11 minutes and 10 seconds to go in this ball game, and Michigan in command right now, not in the ball game in the first half, that is, by a score of 24-3. Well, Todd Slopey all set to do his thing, and that is to kick off. Meanwhile, a couple of fellows from Minnesota trying to do their thing. Castile, number 19, and Dutrell, number 45, trying to bring it back. Already in total offense by Michigan's Steve Smith, a total of 184 yards. That's combined passing and rushing. Taken short this time by Malcolm Nelson. And he does not get to the 20-yard line, closer to the 17. So Slopey getting under that one, but allowing his team really to get down and cover on that kick in good fashion.
Good special teams coverage by Michigan. They don't kick the ball to the end zone. Rather, you kick it high, a lot of hang time, and you really compress the field when you kick it over to that corner. That gives the receiver a lot of room to run, but if you cut him off, you've only got half the field to work with. Defensively, that's what you're looking for.
The Wolverines, of course, trying to chalk up their seventh win in conference play of the 1983 season. Their eighth overall against a couple of losses. By the way, Illinois won their game this afternoon over Indiana. That should wrap up the championship for the Illini. Going no place that time because a fellow by the name of Dave Meredith was leading the way for Michigan. And Meredith shoving the man almost back to the 10-yard line to bring it back to the 13.
Top part of your screen. Meredith just beats the block of the offensive tackle, John Lilleberg. And he is right in the middle of the backfield. Doesn't he get some help? Here's the police. There's Rodney Lyles. And on the bottom is Tim Anderson. That's gang tackling. And Michigan right now, Ray, is controlling both lines of scrimmage. Their defensive line is controlling Minnesota's offensive front. And Randy Rasmussen now has moved back in over at center.
Is that something? Well, he's been a busy man already here in this first half at guard and at center. Hunter is the lone running back in behind the quarterback. A quick look in pass. And it was just mistiming on the part of the young quarterback Sadek that time, as he had McMullen with nobody around him for the first 5 yards, but he was over his head with the throw.
I think you're right when you talk about a young quarterback. I think Brett Sadek right now is getting a little jittery, and maybe Joe Salem is wondering, what do I have to do? He's had a tough year already, and it's getting tougher being down to Michigan with 10-17 left in the first half, and he's down 24-3, but I think Sadek maybe is just a little bit gun-shy here, maybe a little tentative.
Salem, of course, in his fifth year here in Minnesota, and his record in the Big Ten, 12-30-1 coming into this ball game. Third down, and about 13 yards later. Sadek not going to be able to get this one away as he has wrestled the turf right around the 8-yard line. And leading the way again was Carlton Rose.
Coming with a blitz, Ray, from his left linebacker position. Michigan now gambling some. You see Sadek go back. He's looking. There's good coverage in the secondary, but nobody blocks Carlton Rose. And he just drills him right there, knocks him down into the rest of the rush. And Minnesota offensively, after their first and second series, is what we talked about. They are good for their first couple series. Then they just seem to self-destruct.
It's almost like a formula. that's been written in the book for the 83 season for Joe Salem and his Golden Gophers. So again, Adam Kelly to punt from his end zone this time. Gopher was standing around the 50-yard line, and this one is a wobbly kick, bounces up to 35, gets a Minnesota bounce, and across the 40, right around the 42-yard line, and Michigan will have the ball in play at the Minnesota 42 with 9:23 to go. So after a couple of really fine kicks by young Adam Kelly, he has tapered off to 31, 37, and 34 yards in his last three efforts.
And Cooper, of course, turned one of those 30-yarders into a big play, returning it down close. And Michigan in this second quarter has really dominated, and in particular, Ray, their field position has been outstanding.
Well, they have it again now in Minnesota territory at the 42-yard line. First and 10 with Garrett and Rogers, the running backs, in behind Steve Smith. Mark Ray and Bean wide to the right. The tight end Nelson on the left side. And the option play by Smith. Good coverage that time. Minnesota doing a good job to really block up that option pattern as a tailback really was covered.
Exactly. And Steve Smith read that. Now, this is perfect coverage of the option. Down the line of scrimmage. Now, there's got to be one man out there that Steve Smith pitches on. He pitches on, but here you see Sutton up there. He's got Rogers. Smith did a good job not pitching the ball, because had he pitched it, Rick Rogers and Sutton would have met about the same time, and it could have caused a fumble like they did on their first series on the first play of the game from scrimmage for Michigan that gave Minnesota the opportunity to kick their field goal.
A couple of yards on the effort. Make it second down and 8 at the 40-yard line of Minnesota. And again, a whistle. As the officials have indicated that something has gone astray out there. Steve Smith questioning what went wrong, and another delay. And Bo Schembechler, as you can see, definitely not happy with that.
I think he's not happy at the officials, because I think he got the old quick count or the quick clock.
What by in a hurry. Check that stopwatch. It's running fast.
Yeah, I think he's a little upset with the officials. He wasn't yelling at Steve Smith or anybody out there.
All right, second down, 13. Back at the 45-yard line. Here's Rogers, and Rogers gets close to the 35-yard line. Moving up quickly to upend him a little bit was Kevin Taylor again for his second tackle of this ball game.
Straight draw play, and it worked real well. You'll check it. Smith goes back. They're looking for the rush. Inside, good block by the tight end, and there you saw Rogers make the good cut back outside, away from the linebackers. Good call to get the yardage back. You know, they could have gone to the pass, which is what Minnesota was expecting. Instead, they come with the... just a minute. Instead, they come with the draw play.
Rogers very slow coming back to the huddle. I'm trying to tell you, he's a little bit holding his back before this play got underway. Sorry, Jimmy. And over the middle this time to Bean at the 28-yard line. Complete for Smith. Should have enough for the first down. And Kevin Taylor in there to make the stop.
And remember the play we talked about it last week that Illinois ran so successfully, dragging that receiver down over the middle. Minnesota coming with the blitz. You see the linebackers. There is Vince Bean dragging underneath the linebacker coverage. Single coverage. He's able to get into that area of zone, or that man-to-man coverage. He beats him by a step. If you get any blocking against the blitz, he'll come open. Smith was able to step up, hit him with it for the first down.
Kerry Smith and Greg Armstrong in there, the running backs now for Michigan. Armstrong, the fullback. The tailback is Kerry Smith. And Kerry gets the call on that first play that he checks in on and tries to get up to the 25-yard line, right around the 26. Steve Thompson, the tackle on the right side, making the hit for Minnesota. 6 minutes and 55 seconds to go in that first half here at the Metrodome in Minneapolis, and Michigan on top by a score of 24-3.
You talk about games being a chess game, you know, the offense and defenses, coaches trying to outguess each other. Michigan has had Minnesota in a position where they have guessed right, gambled right, when Minnesota has blitzed. And on the other hand, Minnesota has guessed wrong when Michigan's come with a pass and hit them with the big play.
Second down and 8 for the Wolverines. Smith wanting to pass and go deep. Goes to Nelson off his fingertips. Sim Nelson had his man beaten down there in a corner, and Sim could not bring it in. He had beaten Kevin Taylor.
Again, one-on-one coverage. Here is the play action. coming in there, looking like the option. That holds the linebacker. Now they're coming with three people. Good blocking. Nelson is one-on-one with Taylor. He's got him by a step. Hit ball hits him in the hands and goes off. That's a catchable pass. Should have been another touchdown and more total offense for Steve Smith.
All right, we got a third down and eight now for Michigan. And Michigan on the third down conversion so far in this ball game, 3 or 5. And coming in this ball game, 46% in the third down efficiency program for the year. Greg Armstrong in there as the lone running back in behind Steve Smith. The wide receivers on the right side. And coming over the middle is Markray, makes the completed pass. Scatters for the end zone. He's in. Touchdown. So Markray goes in with his second touchdown of this ball game.
And once again, Michigan catches Minnesota in a blitz situation. Single coverage. Big play. Watch it. They're coming with a blitz. Smith is waiting for Markray to come free. He's got one-on-one coverage. Ball thrown a little bit behind him, but there he goes. Now he runs behind Kerry Smith, who does a good job on Taylor, just holding him up. Sutton is the man-to-man coverage man on Markray. He has to follow him all the way across the field, and he cannot catch him before he gets to the end zone.
Well, here's a familiar sight. That's Bob Bergeron standing back to do his thing. Try for the extra point. Kick is good. And Michigan now, after taking only 6 plays to go 42 yards, going on top now by a score of 31-3 with 6 minutes and 13 seconds remaining in the first half. Don't go away. High Michigan all set to kick off and leading this ball game in the first half with 6 minutes and 13 seconds to go by a score of 31-3. Got off to a slow start in the first couple of minutes, but then it's been all Michigan. Utrell, about 3 yards back in the end zone, decides to run it out, and he is greeted at the 15-yard line and shoved back to the 14. Well, you want to see Markray with a second touchdown? Let's take another look.
Well, one of the reasons we talk about them committing linebackers to a blitz and why you gamble. What happens is when you commit linebackers to a blitz, that area underneath is opened up. Now, he normally, on a pass pattern like that in a zone, Markray would be hit by a linebacker taking a zone drop. But in this instance, he was single covered by one man, Sutton, and he got in there where the linebacker should have been, but they were in on a blitz. He was able to cut across the field where, again, that underneath coverage is because they committed him to the linebackers to the blitz. Markray was able to get underneath and make the big play.
A little draw play this time. And a gain of about 4 yards that time on a carry. Rodney Lyles in there to make the stop as Wilson carried for Minnesota. And again, Jimmy, to go back, you see probably more man-to-man coverage by this Minnesota secondary and in their linebackers than you do any other team in the Big Ten.
Well, if Joe Salem, as we see Joe right now, wants to commit his linebackers and people to the rush, then he's got to have one-on-one cover backs back there that can do the job, or that blitz has got to get to the quarterback. It hasn't happened, and what you do when that doesn't happen is you get burned by the big play.
And that's happened in Minnesota again tonight. Another draw play that results in just about to the line of scrimmage. Nate Rogers, the middle guard, nose guard for Michigan on the tackle.
Take a look at the draw, straight draw. Nate Rogers playing real good against the right guard. That's number 64, Jerry Maritko. He just stays there in his place, stalemates him, comes off the block. His responsibility as a middle guard is to watch for the draw.
Wilson on that last carry, he lost a yard. So we go to third down and 8 for Minnesota. Passage situation for Sadek, young quarterback. Swing pass. It comes out to Turner. Breaks a tackle. Gets across the 20. Close to the 23-yard line. They were trying to go to their split end. And that is Lungeon Howard, number 49. But he was being shut off by Cooper. And Howard, a young man out of Detroit's Martin Luther King. As you see, Turner that time, not too happy.
He was the checkoff man, and what happened is that Carlton Rose was out there, did a good job of covering, staying home. He had him one-on-one. He stayed with him. He was able to hit him long enough to allow Cochran to get up and help him with a tackle that didn't allow him to get the first down.
All right, Cooper back there at the 40-yard line of Michigan to take this punt, the 6th punt by Adam Kelly here in the first half. Gets it away. Good, high, towering spiral now down to the 29-yard line. Cooper on the gallop. avoiding tackles, scrambling around, and gets back just to the 35-yard line. A 6-yard return after a 48-yard punt. That time by young Mr. Adam Kelly. Well, we'll talk about what took place this afternoon in the Big Ten. Iowa got quite a defensive struggle, but edged out Michigan State 12-6. Northwestern continue to have problems. Michigan's next week opponent, Ohio State, winning big 55-7. There was one that defense went out the window. Wisconsin held on for a 42-38 win. And Illinois, well, congratulations to the Illini as they wrap things pretty much up in the Big Ten and they get set to head for the Rose Bowl with that big win over Indiana. Michigan trying to hang down on second place tonight. Coming out to Seb Nelson, the tight end. Gets a pretty good block and gets down in the Minnesota territory at the 31-yard line.
Minnesota's secondary, Ray, has just been rocked. Sim Nelson comes off the line of scrimmage. He gets in the zone between the two linebackers. Here's a good look at it. As Minnesota commits a linebacker to the blitz, they come over the middle, one-on-one coverage of the tight end with a linebacker. Good block coming back by Kattis, the other tight end. And Sim Nelson gets a big play right down the middle. I wouldn't doubt if that was an audible. Smith saw the blitz coming, went to an audible to Sim Nelson just over the middle, and they come up with a big play.
For Sim, that one worth 32 yards in the pass, and worth 32, of course, for Steve Smith and the Wolverines. On the option, Smith pitching now to Kerry Smith. Cuts it back in and close to the 20-yard line. Good running after taking the pitch out from Steve Smith. As a young man from Grand Rapids turns it down to the 20, should be enough for the first down for the Wolverines.
The option play to the outside is there. Belordis is pulling. He logs the end inside. Now there's only one man to take, Smith or Kerry Smith. Kerry Smith gets the pitch. Now he does a good job of running, cutting it back against the grain, and he's into the secondary, and Taylor, a cornerback, has to come up and make the stop.
For Kerry Smith, he accomplishes the 11th first down for the Wolverines in this first half, down to 3 minutes and 8 seconds. First and 10 off the 20-yard line for the Wolverines. Mark, Ray, and Bean wide on the left side. Armstrong and Kerry Smith, the running backs. It's Kerry Smith again. Couldn't find the hole that he wanted. Decided to try to slip outside. And he gave a little shove to Armstrong. Armstrong was trying to find somebody to block, but it was all bottled up over there on the right side.
That is a play where Minnesota gambling defensively worked because Kerry Smith went to the line of scrimmage and there were too many people there for Michigan's offense to block. And he could just barely get enough room to get some yardage. He got a yard out of it, but he was lucky to do that.
Second down and 9 for the Wolverines just inside the 20-yard line of Minnesota. Again, Mark Ray and Bean. Wide to the left. Sim Nelson, the tight end on the right side. Smith with plenty of time. Goes out to Sim Nelson, and Nelson is down around the 12-yard line. That time, a linebacker. Tessier coming through to make the stop on Nelson.
But once again, that time was a straight zone. You'll see 39, Christopherson, the linebacker. He's got that one back, one-on-one. Nelson goes to the other side, just stands over by the sideline, and that linebacker has him covered one-on-one. There are three backs in the secondary watching for the deep pass, but in a situation like that, linebackers isolated on backs or tight ends, you're going to get those guys open.
All right, a second down, rather third down and 2. Michigan 3-of-5 on the third down conversion. And firing and broken up that time. And Jennifer Nelson. And Deuce Quebec in there to break it up. And I tell you, Steve Smith had to put something on that because Nelson was open just momentarily, and then the linebacker was moving over quickly in front of him.
Exactly. Deuce Quebec opened up. There was about a yard or two in there. He had to thread the needle. Deuce Quebec, with his quickness, was able to get a hand on it and knock it away.
Well, I think maybe this is the first time tonight that the Wolverines faced with a fourth down situation, fourth down and some short yardage here. And they will be going for it. Bracken has been back to punt one time for the Wolverines in this first half. Need a couple of yards. Armstrong and Kerry Smith, the running backs. Steve Smith on the option. The right side. First down, Michigan. Kerry Smith taking that pitch out. And over there to cover on Smith was Kerry Glenn, the safety, that tripped him up. But they got the first down.
Good play into the short side of the field. Coming down the line with the option. The inside is all logged up. And there you see the pitch. Now, Kerry Glenn has to come over from his safety spot. Kerry Smith knows he only needs a yard, so he just goes over the top. That's all he wanted was that first down.
Michigan with its 12th first down in this ball game. with a minute and 20 seconds to go in the first half. First and goal at the 8-yard line. And Steve Smith coming around over the middle, fires, and Sim Nelson stays in the end zone, bobbles the ball, finally finds a handle, and has a touchdown.
And Ray, absolutely nobody covered him on that pattern. I think this must have been a mistaken coverage. Left side of your screen, Sim Nelson runs right down the middle of the field. He is wide open right now. Smith throws it up there. Nelson juggles it and falls into the end zone in possession, touchdown. I think a mistaken coverage, and maybe it was Dusbebek who didn't get over there with him. He probably had him one-on-one, and Sim Nelson just ran right by him.
And you can see that official watching Nelson to make sure that he was going to be not over that line and be out of the playing surface. Here's Bergeron with a try for the extra point. Aha, he has it. And so with 1 minute and 11 seconds to go in the first half, the Wolverines really trampling on the Gophers, 38-3.
And it has been the big play, as we talked about, beginning of the game. Michigan has come up with all the big plays. Steve Smith going 75 yards on one. We had the big touchdown pass from Smith to Markray. And again, Minnesota has given Michigan the opportunity to hit those because of the fact that defensively they've gambled and Michigan has caught them gambling.
Michigan with its fourth touchdown here in the second quarter and a commanding lead of 38-3. So Smith has fired for three touchdown passes.
And I think if it keeps going like it is, those cheerleaders of the Michigan Wolverines doing those backflips are going to be dizzy by the time this one is over with.
Really need the Sunday rest, won't they? Hey, we're very glad you can join us on this Saturday night along our Wolverine Sports Television Network. As Schlofe kicks it off, and it's taken at the 7-yard line this time and brought up by Malcolm Nelson across the 20-yard line, and one of the few times that the Gophers have gambled and got across the 20-yard line and not taken the ball for a touchback or come up short inside their own 20 on a kickoff. First and 10, Gophers at the 22-yard line. Well, the way things are going right now, Jim, I would say that Bo and his staff will have a chance to look at all the guys they brought along on this trip tonight.
Yeah, he's already got Jeff Cohen in the game playing at one of the safety positions.
Nate Rogers in there now at that nose guard position for Michigan. Castile bobbling the ball, never had possession, and finally trickled out of bounds. He got out of bounds. The ball was going out of bounds, and it's incomplete. And Cohen on the coverage.
Straight drop back pass, and you can see Meredith is in at left tackle. Michigan kind of emptying off their bench a little bit. And a good pass hits Castile right in the chest, and he bobbles it around. There you see Cohen coming up. He drills him in the back, and that could have been an interception. That's Andy Moeller, number 49, I believe, in the game, also at linebacker for Michigan, taking over for Mike Mallory.
Second and 10 for the Gophers. Trying to the air again. And the reception is made over there. Enough for the first down. The official ruling, Hartwig, was out of bounds when he made the catch. So with a score of 38-3, things not going too well for the Golden Gophers. And you get living testimony along the bench of the faces of those young men. Ironic that Joe Salem has announced his resignation, and Joe had 8 new assistants come in at the beginning of this campaign, and well, situations wanted got to be out for those fellows. So the search is on, and they hope to have a decision made by December 3rd here in Minnesota who their new head man will be. Third down and 10. And over the middle and off the fingertips of Fred Hartwig. Boy, he had running room had he made the reception.
Boy, you talk about a big play. Had Hartwig held on to that football, he could have gone the distance because he caught Michigan in that zone, and he had beat the underneath coverage and was on a dead run. And there were only one or two people back there that were able to catch him. It would have been Cooper, and I don't know whether Evan could have changed directions and made the tackle on Hartwig.
Minnesota, so far, their offense has run 21 plays, 7 on the ground and 14 in the air, for a total of the yardage. They've not been able to make 7 yards on the rush and 14 on a pass. Cooper bringing that one back, and again Michigan in Minnesota territory, right around the 43-yard line of the Golden Gophers. So Cooper having a big night on the punt returns.
Boy, after the first 5 minutes of this ball game, it has just been totally one-sided. Michigan has done everything imaginable offensively to beat Minnesota, and then defensively they have taken them right out of their game plan, and they just cannot do anything, and now they're tentative and dropping passes.
Down to 40 seconds of the first half. Armstrong and Kerry Smith, the running backs. Kerry Smith gets the ball from Steve Smith, breaks a couple of tackles, and winds up at the 25-yard line of Minnesota. Finally covered up that time by the cornerback, Dutrell.
And there was nothing to that play, just straight blocking at the point of attack, draw play. They spread the defensive lineman out. Kerry Smith has got a big hole. There you see DiOrio and a fullback out in front of him. And then Kerry Smith just does a good job of running, picking his way through the defensive secondary.
And for Kerry, his biggest yardage on the ground tonight, a total of 18 yards on that last carry by young Mr. Smith. Steve Smith looking and firing to Nelson. And does he hang on to it? We'll wait for the official to call. And they're going to rule it completed pass at the 16-yard line.
Yeah, that's the second pass Sim Nelson has bobbled around. One, he bobbled in the end zone and actually had it fall on his chest for a touchdown. Sim Nelson comes all the way across the field underneath the linebacker. You see Christofferson, 39, tried to get him, but he didn't have him. Now, what does he catch the ball? He does have possession when he hits the ground. That's a good call by the official, because that was a play where Nelson had his back to the one side, Judge, and to the deep back, Judge, he must have come up and seen it. But that was a good catch, even though we thought from up here he might have bobbled it and trapped it when he hit the ground. But he did have possession.
So Nelson making the reception. Meanwhile, Steve Smith conferring to the sidelines with Bo Schembechler with 12 seconds remaining this first half. And that ball marked the 16-yard line of Minnesota. Minnesota's outside linebacker, Mark Dusebeck, has checked out. He was limping out of the lineup, and Larry Joyner, number 20, has checked in. So everything has gone Michigan's way since the first couple of minutes in this ball game. There are 12 seconds remaining in the half, and the Wolverines would like to go in with some more points if they could. Steve Smith is thinking that way. One-on-one to Vince Bean. Overshoots him by a couple of yards in the end zone. He was covered over there by Kevin Taylor, and Taylor had some help from Kerry Glenn. 8 seconds remaining. And Bergeron has checked in. So Bergeron will try for his second field goal of this half. And he can set a record now for one season. As he can get this one to the upright successfully, it'll be his 13th field goal of the 83 season, breaking the old mark of 12 by Ali Haji Sheik. Timeout called by Minnesota. So we got a timeout with 8 seconds. That'll give a little extra time for Bergeron to think things over. Michigan leading by a score of 38-3. Quiet crowd on hand here at the Metrodome, and they haven't had much to cheer about since about 10 minutes and 11 seconds to go in the first quarter, when they got a 29-yard field goal from Gowrie, and that really has been their offense tonight.
Yeah, and this is a beautiful facility, Ray. I know this is the first time you and I both have been here, and it is a beautiful facility, very similar to the Pontiac Silverdome, except a little bit smaller. And, of course, it is built for both baseball and football and soccer and whatever other events that they want to get in here.
In football, 62,500. They accommodate for baseball, 54,791. And when they have concerts in here, 72,000. But they are shy on their 41,000 expected crowd tonight at the Metrodome. Okay, here's Bergeron. And Bergeron trying the 33-yard effort. He has the distance, and he has it. And Bergeron owns a new season mark in field goals with this three-pointer, his 13th of the year, and with 4 seconds to go on the clock in the first half, it's Michigan leading Minnesota now by a score of 41-3. The score here, and 31 points in the second quarter by Michigan. That has been the most productive quarter for the Wolverines over this season. And when you take a look at Minnesota coming in this ball game, Minnesota had given up an average of 44.3 points per game over the nine games they had played this year, including the non-conference ball games. And Michigan right now in the first half with 41 points.
Tough situation for the Gophers, Ray. They're just totally outmanned and out of this game already.
Scriver bouncing over their head. And now Castile decides that he's going to let somebody else try for it. And that was Malcolm Nelson that finally found the handle. So it'll be brought out to the 20-yard line. And that was really an effective kick by Schlope.
Sometimes a kicker will do that by design. If there is an open seam in the kick coverage, they will try a... It's not actually a squib kick. They try to kick the ball about midway, hit a line drive or knuckleball, and then hope to get a bounce through into the end zone.
And with an artificial surface like they have here, you can really get that bounce.
Similar to baseball, when you get a high hopper that normally on a grass field would be an easy out, it'll slip through the middle for a base hit.
Johnny Hunter checks in now at the fullback position, or rather the tailback position, for Minnesota to go with Kevin Wilson, the fullback, in that pro set now. First and 10 at the 20 for Minnesota. And going deep. And pass is out of bounds. Lot over there to cover, but he was outside. Intended for Dwayne McMullen. That is the end of the first half. It's all Michigan after the first 30 minutes. The Wolverines, 41. Golden Gophers of Minnesota, 3.
Here in Minneapolis tonight, the University of Michigan has just really gone to their favorite color, maize and blue, leading at halftime over Minnesota by a score of 41-3. And a fellow that's putting on a pretty good show is Steve Smith, but he's getting some good blocking, too.
Yeah, he's getting some good blocking, and I think Minnesota is allowing Michigan to make the big plays by what they're doing defensively. And you mentioned that Michigan was putting on their colors, maize and blue. I would more like to say that Minnesota has become black and blue by the way that Michigan has really manhandled them.
Minnesota, with about 11 minutes to go in the first quarter, came through with a three-point field goal, a 29-yard effort, a brief lead. Just about 6.5 minutes later, Michigan had about 89 yards to go for a touchdown, and they didn't waste much time.
No, it was the option play, and Steve Smith came down the line of scrimmage, turned it up inside, and again, the reason this play goes the distance, 75 yards, is because Minnesota gambles defensively and comes up to support the run extremely quick with their secondary people. Once Steve Smith got by the linebackers, there was nobody but secondary people back there. Smith was able to split them and go the distance, 75 yards, to make it a 7-3 game.
Before that quarter, first quarter ended, Bergeron had added a 39-yard field goal. And I think maybe in the second quarter, maybe Minnesota was looking for the run.
Michigan came out, and I think more than anything, they're calling some audibles, trying to catch Minnesota in that gambling, stunting, sending linebacker type situation in against you to stop the run. When they do that, you commit linebackers inside. What happens is you have to single cover secondary people with wide receivers. Now, the wide receiver, Markray, makes the catch here on Michigan's second touchdown. He only has to beat one man, Sutton. When he made the catch, Sutton overran him, and there was nobody around to help out. Normally, in normal zone defenses in the secondary, you'll have a safety over there. You'll have somebody helping the cornerback out. But by committing linebackers to a rush to stop the run, you force your secondary people one-on-one, and if the one guy that you have on your receiver doesn't make the tackle, you're looking at some big trouble.
So what's that mean? Well, it means that Minnesota couldn't move the ball after that touchdown pass. 2.5 minutes later, Michigan had the ball again.
The option again. And this time, Minnesota goes outside and covers it up pretty good. So Steve Smith cuts it back up inside. But see right there? Once he's 5 yards into the secondary, there's nobody around him. That's because their safeties and secondary people are up there looking for the run. Smith saw it, was able to get into the end zone.
All right, 5 minutes later, Michigan's got the ball again. This time they decide to go to the air, and it paid off again.
Again, coming with a blitz. The linebackers are coming. They're normally in a drop zone. Markray runs right where the linebackers vacated. Normally on this catch, he's going to have to run through linebackers, or the ball won't be there because linebackers will be in coverage right in front of him. If they weren't because they came on a blitz, Markray was able to beat the one man covering him to the corner of the end zone. Touchdown, and Michigan started blowing him out at that point.
Michigan added another touchdown, another field goal from Bergeron. That's a new season record for field goal kickers, 13 in one season, and leading now by a score of 41-3. and I think both teams might be tired, Michigan tired for going to the end zone so much.
And I think we'll see a lot of new names and a lot of new faces in the second half. And really, I think a good idea for Michigan, because now they'll be able to give their starters some rest going into that big one next week against Ohio State.
Okay, we'll have the second half in just a moment.
The second half of University of Michigan football is brought to you by Stroh Signature, the beer with something extra. By National Steel Corporation, National driving for number one in quality, delivery, and price. And by Republic Airlines, nobody serves our republic like Republic.
And our second half is underway as Jim Galvery sends it down to Kerry Smith about 5 yards deep into the Michigan end zone. Automatic catchback in the Wolverines will bring it out to the 20-yard line. Second half underway, and for the first half, the story. Take a look at the first downs. You want to take a look at the score, of course, 41-3 Michigan. But Minnesota only coming up with one first down in that first half. The rushing department strictly lopsided, as is the passing department.
The rushing yardage, 201 yards in the first half, 75 of it coming on a Steve Smith touchdown run. But, Ray, that shows the complete domination of Michigan. And the 17 attempts, I think, by Steve Smith is the reason the score is so big, but also because Minnesota's giving them the opportunity to throw and make the big play.
Michigan starting that first unit as they come around with the reverse with Bean moving from the left to the right side. Breaks a tackle on the far side of the field. Looked as if he was going to be tossed for a couple of yards loss and turns it into an 8-yard gain. Joe Christopherson finally forces him out of bounds.
Well, that's a great run by Vince Bean. We have seen him in the secondary doing some pretty decent running, but it's the first time we've seen him this year on the end around. And he came around there, and I don't know how he got around the corner and got by Graffunder, who was out there to make the tackle. All the action is going to the right of your screen. Here comes Bean. Now, here's where he uses his speed. He gets outside Graffunder and then Sutton and turns upfield and tight ropes down the sideline.
So they need a couple of yards for the first down. A call goes out to the fullback, and that's Eddie Garrett on the carry, and he has the first down across the 30-yard line, close to the 33-yard line, a gain of 5. So it'll be first down and 10 for Michigan at the Wolverine 33-yard line. That first unit staying intact here as we start the second half, and certainly for the Golden Gophers cheering crew, their cheerleaders, they have not had much to cheer about since about the first 4 or 5 minutes of that first quarter. Bean and Mark Rays, but wide on the left side out of your picture at the present time. The running backs are Garrett and Rick Rogers. And Rogers on the carry, following his blocking on that right side, just slanting a little bit between tackle and in, and picking up maybe 3 yards on that carry. Across the 35 to the 30 to mark it, between the 37 and 38, mark it at the 38-yard line, and it will give him a gain of 4, second down and 6.
One of the things I think we'll see Minnesota do the second half defensively, Ray, is I don't think they'll gamble as much defensively. I think they'll play a straight 4-3. And not allow Michigan to get that big play.
Same backfield alignment, and the wide receivers are on the left side. They'll try the option play. Rogers taking it, trying to cut back in. He gets across the 40 to about the 42, 43-yard line. That's on the secondary moving up, and a little quickness that time by Christopherson also in there, the middle linebacker moving over quickly.
Yeah, but I think Rick Rogers, if he would have kept running outside and not tried to turn it back, he would have gotten enough yardage for the first down. But he tried to cut back, and he ran right into three people who were coming on pursuit. In a situation like that, you run for the first down marker, you keep going straight up the field. Rick trying to cut it back and slow down cost him probably 3 yards.
Got 5 yards on the carry. And so shy, maybe about a foot. So it's third down and less than a yard to go for that first down for Michigan, marked at the Wolverine 43-yard line. Mark Ray checking out of there. Vince Bean also checks out. In a short yardage situation, double tight end employed by Michigan. I use Armstrong in motion. A couple of fullbacks in there, and Kerry Smith following that blocking on the right side, close to the 50-yard line. They'll mark it at the 50. Wolverines have the first down. And Christopherson along with Glenn in there to make the stop.
Vince Bean. Minnesota, they're in a goal line defense right down there. Now watch, a little crease breaks right over there. Kerry Smith, if he runs out of that tackle by Kristofferson, could have gone the distance. But in the middle of the field, that's very dangerous defensively to run a goal line defense like that. Because when you do something like that, you're opening yourself up once again for that big play because you don't have secondary people coming up there to support against the run.
15th first down by the Wolverines. Bean and Markre back in there. Split on the left side, the bottom of your screen. First and 10, the option play. Smith breaks it up the middle. Might be on his way for the third touchdown. He'll go all the way. Check for the flags. No flags. Touchdown, Michigan.
Minnesota gambled again and got beat. Steve Smith turned it back up inside. Right, Minnesota's safety was only 5 yards off the ball. Now here comes the option. Down the line, they're coming outside with the blitz. Smith sees it, cuts it back up inside. Now right there is the safety, Kerry Glenn. There's nobody left. He's all alone in the secondary. Normally, on a regular defense, when you're not gambling, you'll have a safety man or a cornerback over on that backside to prevent the cutback. Minnesota did not have that, and Smith was able to get way free into the secondary and get in for the touchdown.
Oh, and Michigan showing a devastating attack at the expense of the Golden Gophers. Bergeron putting the try for the extra point up. It is good. So Michigan going 6 plays, moving 80 yards, and taking only 2 minutes and 41 seconds off the clock. And Michigan now leading by a score of 48-3. A kickoff, and with that touchdown gallop of 50 yards, Smith with a career high in the rushing department for 147 yards by himself. In this ball game, with still 12 minutes and 19 seconds to go in the third quarter. But for Steve, 147 yards on the ground. Total offense for Michigan tonight, for Smith that is, 322 yards passing and on the ground.
Boy, the last two games, Ray, Steve Smith has been unbelievable.
And that mark of 322 is only 8 yards short of an all-time Michigan record. Could happen. Here's the kickoff. Castile, 5 yards back. Now bring it out. 15. Gets outside. 25. Had only one man to beat, and he might have gone down the sideline. So something to cheer about for Minnesota fans. And for Michigan, it was Schlope over there to force him out of bounds.
What happens is Michigan comes down the field on this run back, and they really are spread out into the middle of the field. And Castile makes a cut right about the 7-yard line, make it to 12 to the outside. There he is. Now Michigan is all logged up inside. And finally, it is Schlope who knocks him out of bounds, and there you saw his right foot hit the out-of-bounds mark.
First and 10 now for Minnesota at the 27 of the Golden Gophers. Michigan on top, 48-3. Sad third quarter just underway. And Reed on the carry, fumble, and a scramble for it right around the 35-yard line for Minnesota, and I believe the Gophers retain possession. Allen Reed with his first carry tonight.
Looked like Randy Rasmussen got on the ball. Kevin Brooks comes in from a nose guard position, and he'll pull the arm down of the back. Now, he knocks the ball loose. Now, there's Rasmussen. Rasmussen kicks it. Now, he keeps after it. That's great concentration and good hustle by that big center to fall on that fumble.
And I stand corrected. I give the credit on a carry that time to Malcolm Nelson. Malcolm Nelson, 34. Reed is 24. Here comes Nelson again, but does not find the opening he found the last time. He's plugged up right around the 32-yard line at the bottom of that pile for Michigan, doing a good job. Here's Nate Rogers.
Here's the touchdown by Steve Smith. See number 8, that is the safety, Kerry Glenn. He comes outside. Now, he's the last line of defense. That's what Minnesota is doing defensively. They're bringing their safeties up on the ball, so concerned about blitzing and forcing Michigan into mistakes that when you get past that safety man, there's nobody left. And that's what Michigan has hit Minnesota with all game long.
Nickel defense being employed now by the Wolverines on a 3rd and 5. The Gophers, as Hewlett checked back in there. And Nelson going nowhere. Nelson wrapped up in pretty good fashion by Tim Anderson. At least Anderson on top on that play. And at the bottom of the pile, DeFelice also getting some credit for the tackle, and Brett Cochran. So they fail to get a first down at the 31-yard line. And a story on Joe Salem as he talks with his young quarterback. His fifth season will be his final season here at Minnesota. Adam Kelly back to punt. Cooper back to take that punt. Good high spiral. Cooper, the far side of the field, the hash mark at the 32-yard line, trying to get outside. Makes a corner, gets it outside, and runs out of bounds at the 45-yard line. 38-yard punt that time. And Minnesota really, on the special teams, let Cooper off the hook that time.
Yeah, Evan Cooper got around the corner. Probably never should have made the turn around the corner. But everything is going right for Michigan's way. They're just able to do pretty much everything they want to do. And Evan Cooper is part of the whole situation. Here he makes the cut outside. But now, here's where he shouldn't have made the corner. But he ran right through a tackle. And he's able to make probably 10, 12 yards out of where he shouldn't have had anything.
He gets a 14-yard return on that one. Here's a pitch out to Gerald White, taking his first play, puts the head down, and White carries to the 44-yard line. Perriman and White in there, and Dave Hall, the quarterback. So a new backfield for Michigan here with 9 minutes and 48 seconds to go in the third quarter. Gerald White, number 22. You see Perriman, number 37. Hall in there now, number 7, the quarterback. As Steve Smith has given away to Dave Hall.
Up front for Michigan, Bob Tabatino into the game now for Stephon Humphreys. Doug James is at the quick tackle. The quick guard is Jerry DiOrio.
Second down and 11 at the 44 of Michigan. And Hall, wanting the pass, forced out of the pocket, will have to run. Trying to get out of bounds, it does, at the Minnesota 48-yard line. I'll tell you, they were a little gentle on Hall that time. Somebody could have really blasted him. Bruce Holmes, the defensive end, a former tight end, had a shot at him and just sort of gave him the shoulder instead of blasting him out of bounds. At the 48.
David Hall, of course, you remember last year in the Rose Bowl, had to come in for the injured Steve Smith. And all season long, Steve Smith has had that injury up until last week, really, when his right arm was completely healed up from the separation that he received in the Rose Bowl, that David Hall had to come in and play in that Rose Bowl game last January 1st. Even in a losing effort, did a real good job.
He did. He was 13 for 24 in that bowl game. Here is Gerald White on the carry going outside. He might have got a couple of yards trying to skirt that right in. Not enough for the first down. Close to the 42-yard line. They may mark it at the 41. Bracken checking in. I believe for Bracken, this will be only his second punt of the evening for Michigan.
He had one blocked earlier in the game, Ray, and that was when Michigan seemed to be sleepwalking.
Yep.
Earlier in the first 10 minutes of this football game, and then they woke up in a hurry.
Hartwig going back deep to take the punt from Bracken. Hartwig from Minnesota at his 10-yard line. And Bracken gets it away. Hartwig elects not to try to make the catch. He gets the bounce that he was looking for. Scampers into the end zone. 47 yards on the punt, and for Don Bracken, certainly a lot better than he's been doing in the past. Timeout. Michigan dominating this ball game 48-3. 8 minutes and 20 seconds to go in the third quarter. Michigan 48, Minnesota 3. First and 10 for the Gophers. McMullen, a flanker, goes back in a setback position now. Sadek back to pass, looking for somebody, and overshoots McMullen that time, heading for the sideline. Cohen covering on the play, right around the 21-yard line, incomplete.
And Ray, some changes on the Michigan defense. Jim Scarcelli is at one end for either Rodney Lyles or Carlton Rose. Jeff Cohen is in the secondary. Gerald Akers in at a linebacker. He is teamed up with Andy Moeller. Moeller coming back from that ankle injury he had earlier this year. The secondary, Gant, Lott, Rich Hewlett, Garland Rivers, and Jeff Cohen.
A young Mr. Akers, who has a brother playing at UCLA, couldn't have been too happy. At least his brother wasn't today. What happened at Arizona as the Utes lose. Pass is completed to McMullen this time at the 30-yard line. Should be enough for a first down. But it's nice to be able to see some of those reserve linebackers, to see the reserves get in the ball game to get the experience.
Exactly. And Michigan here is playing kind of a holding pattern. Their secondary is giving a lot of air, a lot of cushion to receivers. McMullen just goes out, and you see John Lott giving him about 4 yards, and McMullen just heads out of bounds. That's a safe pass to throw in Minnesota's situation right now. Michigan, of course, wants to force them to go the long way. They don't want to give up the big play. It's 48-3, and they'll be happy, I think, to just cover up in the middle and not let Minnesota make big plays on it.
Minnesota needs a yard for the first down. They are 0-for-9 in third down conversions in this ball game tonight. Needing a yard. Wilson trying to cut back. He's going to be thrown for the loss. Does not get the first down. Minnesota is really stopped again by needing a yard, and it was Andy Moeller leading the way for Michigan. So the Golden Gophers 0-for-10 trying to get that third down conversion.
And give Mike Hammerstein some credit, too. Hammerstein is in there at a defensive tackle, and he really got penetration, much similar to Illinois a couple years back when he stopped them on the goal line getting penetration into the backfield. He did it there, forced the back outside off his normal route, and really helped Moeller on the tackle.
Here's Gant back to take this punt. And bouncing around, it goes out of bounds at the 18-yard line. Gant studied that one a little bit before he decided to go after it on the punt from Adam Kelly. And Kelly gets credit this time for a 48-yard effort. So he's had a pretty good night with a toe, and he probably has been the most valuable player in this ball game for Minnesota. Of course, the Michigan cheerleaders with nothing, like nothing better than to add a few more cheers to that score right now, 48-3 with 7:26 to go.
Well, then again, maybe they don't want him to add any more points. He'll have to do more flip-flops over there. And like I said, if it gets any worse, they'll get dizzy. They have been doing a lot of those this evening.
First and 10, Michigan. And putting the head down and rumbling was Kerry Smith. Kerry Smith getting close to that first down. And we have said it maybe a dozen times this year, but you really get an effort from Kerry. Looks like he's going to be bottled up, and somehow he gets out of there and gets some yards.
Yeah, he does. But look at the hole. Look at it open up there as Michigan gets Belordis 59 folding through, and he kicks on the linebacker. Now, Kerry Smith puts his head down, keeps his feet moving in that traffic, and both hands on the football. He is on to the safety and the cornerback, Taylor, before they're able to wrap him up. Good blocking at the point of attack. Good hard running by Kerry Smith.
All handing it off now to his fullback, looked like Armstrong. And Armstrong picking up a yard to the 35-yard line. The line of scrimmage at the 34. Christofferson, the middle linebacker, making the tackle. So Armstrong getting a couple of calls in this ball game tonight. And really seeing a little bit more service as Rice is out with that bad neck, and get a little more service in there than he has seen most of the season except for the first ball game.
Right, and Bo Schembechler is putting some of his reserves in there. He's got Eric Kattis at tight end in place of Sim Nelson. Mark Hammerstein is the strong side tackle. Tabaccino, Diorio, the guards. Belordis, the center, and a quick tackle is Doug James.
All right, second down and about 8 yards needed. And Kerry Smith on that carry, close to the 40, mark it at the 39-yard line.
Michigan's wideouts in there are number 26, Gilvani Johnson, and number 24, I believe, Steve Johnson is on the other side, right? Dave Hall, the quarterback, Greg Armstrong, the fullback, and now Gerald White comes into the game as the tailback, as the Minnesota Golden Gophers get something to cheer about, as the cheerleader is balancing a megaphone on his nose.
How about that, Fez? Third down and 5. Oh, with a long count this time. Getting plenty of good protection. Goes to Kattis, the tight end. And Kattis makes the reception at the Michigan 47-yard line. And for Kattis, his first reception of the year.
Once again, Minnesota coming with an all-out blitz from the outside. Armstrong picks up the blitzer, but Kattis is one-on-one with a safety, Andy Hare, and all Kattis does is run down the field to the first down yard marker and turn it out toward the sideline. He was the only receiver Hall looked at, but he was open because he had single coverage.
So he gets a first down at the 47-yard line. They got to mark it at the 48, first and 10. And Kerry Smith on the handoff, breaks a couple of tackles, and pulls his way deep into the territory, across the 40, right around the 39-yard line of Minnesota, and finally, Duesbelbeck in there to make the hit.
Kerry Smith just runs hard every time you see him, and here's another example. He's not big, he's not fast, but he slips through holes, he slips tackles. Watch this, he runs right through the tackle by Sutton. Now he puts his head down, shows power, and Duesbelbeck has to get him from behind, and he actually helped carry him a couple more yards. But It's the kind of thing that's surprising about Kerry Smith. He doesn't have that great size or speed, and yet he'll fool you with some power.
Well, our statistician tonight, Bruce Motti, informs us that Kerry now has carried the ball 9 times for a total of 68 yards. Well, we have that injured player being worked on. We've got a timeout. Michigan leading Minnesota 48-3. Well, shaking up for Minnesota is Andy Hare. And Andy is the free safety coming off. Seems to be okay now.
You know, Andy Hare did get in and play some quarterback this season also. He is a real good athlete, but they needed help defensively in their secondary, so they moved Hare, who's a good athlete, from a quarterback spot into the secondary where he's gotten a start. But earlier this year, he had thrown a couple of passes and had played some quarterback.
And Hare's backup man, Jeff Kyle, number 18, also a free safety, came in scholarship here from Minnesota also as a quarterback, but he's not the free safety, you know, only a freshman. On the carry, close to the 35-yard line. That time, it was Armstrong. Armstrong greeted by Christopherson. I talked about Bruce Motti informing us also that Hull has lettered in basketball, track, and football at Michigan, and he's the only Bo Schembechler athlete to accomplish that feat. So that's something for Mr. Hull. He has been busy. And he's busy in this ball game right now, taking over for Steve Smith. 4:19 to go here in the third quarter. Second down and 7. All rolling out. Trying to turn the corner, does. Breaks a couple of tackles. Really got away from two men. And he showed a little speed that we haven't seen from Hall before that time. And a gopher on the far side of the field that was trying to make the hit.
That's Craig Graffunder over there. This is the surprise of David Hall, because we didn't think he had this kind of speed. But he'll get outside. Now watch him turn that inside shoulder down and actually turn the corner. And then he just dives in there. He didn't want to take any big hits. But that was a good job turning what would look like a loss into a pretty decent gain.
So they work on Graffunder over by the Michigan bench, and he took a pretty good hit from Doug James right along the sideline.
Well, what worries me most, Ray, is that he's over there laying down near those yard markers, and you just hate to have an athlete going out of bounds at this kind of speed and sometimes at a kind of an oblique angle, and they can hit those down markers, even though the officials that are carrying those chains are supposed to let those down onto the ground. Sometimes you can really get hurt that way. Take a look at Doug James, 73, right part of your screen. He is the guy that hits it. And it wasn't the yard markers, because those yard markers were down on the ground flat. So it must have been the hit from James, and he twisted a knee or something, because I saw them rolling up the left knee pants of Craig Graffunder.
So while they work on the injured Minnesota ball player, Hall and his coach Bo Schembechler conferring here with 3:58 to go in this third quarter. Michigan on top by a score of 48-3. The half wound up 41-3 with Michigan on top, and Steve Smith has capped off his evening early stages of the third quarter on a 50-yard gallop to give Michigan a 47-3 lead, and Bergeron was perfect with the extra point. So Smith with long tallies tonight on the ground of 75 yards, 23 yards, and a 50-yard gallop. For Smith, 327 yards of total offense.
I bet you these guys have seen enough of Steve Smith for a career. Especially tonight.
Really a dejected bench of Minnesota. And why not? It's been a season that has been a nightmare for them.
You know,
looks like a very serious injury over here, because they have brought out the utility cart now to take Graffunder back out of the stands and back to the first aid room and the locker room.
And it's one of the things that head coach Joe Salem of Minnesota, I'm sure, doesn't like to see, is his players injured. They've had enough trouble this year mentally going through the kind of season they're going through, and to have a young man get hurt so that he needs the utility cart to take him into the locker room is, I'm sure, especially upsetting. You know, Minnesota just can't afford any more injuries too, right? They already have 18 freshmen lined up in their two deep. Graffunder's backup is number 70, Mike Peel, and Peel is also a freshman, which would leave them with three freshmen in their starting down four linemen. And when you're that young and that green, a team of Michigan's caliber with experienced depth is going to hurt you. And that's the situation Minnesota's found themselves in all season long. Their leading tackler, Peter Najarian, is lost for the season.
Armstrong on a carry, needed a couple of yards for the first down. He has 20 and a little more to go with that across the 25-yard line, around the 23. of Minnesota. They mark it at the 24-yard line, but still at the first down for Michigan. And Grafunder, we were talking about the injured player, a young man that's a junior, so he has another year of eligibility here out of Fridley, Minnesota. But he's been a good one, and he's been a pretty steady ball player for him this year. It's a shame. See, Gilvani Johnson, number 24. Steve Johnson and Gilvani Johnson, number 26 in the lineup now. On the option play, Armstrong. Boy, he's showing a little reckless abandon tonight inside the 15-yard line, very close to the 13-yard line, and he was had some steam going that time.
You know, Greg Armstrong really hadn't had a chance to carry the ball too much, but again, the blocking at the point of attack. Tabuccino, good block. Then Doug James coming all the way from his quick tackle position, logs the linebacker down inside, and Armstrong cut it back behind that block of Doug James coming across, and there are just large, huge holes in there. And the offensive line is getting some real good experience in there, and some of these guys are the second stringers, and that's real good experience for them in competition like this.
Six first downs now in this half for Michigan. Kerry Smith taking the handoff that time from Hall, sliding to his right, and didn't get much yardage. Line of scrimmage was at the 13, and there'll be no gain. They'll mark it right at the 13-yard line. Second down and 10 to go. Well, sometimes a little bit hard to smile. Other times, you can be jubilant when things are going your way. And the cheerleaders from Minnesota look a little tired tonight. Been tough to cheer. Here's Armstrong inside the five, close to the one-yard line. Greg Armstrong doing the job, the senior out of Middleton, Ohio.
Minnesota defensively really working hard to stop the outside, and Hall gave it to Armstrong right up over the middle. There you see it again. Good, tough blocking at the point of attack. They just shove everybody out of the way, and then Armstrong cuts it back behind the pursuit. Kind of a cutback because Minnesota is flowing to stop the outside play. When a defense does that, you hit them back up in the inside.
First and goal for Michigan. First and goal at the one-yard line. Armstrong has his first touchdown of the 1983 season. From 1 yard out, he pulls his way in. And Michigan just continues to roll over Minnesota.
At the point of attack, there is a huge hole right there. And that, the right tackle over there is number 78, Mark Hammerstein. And he just pushed Steve Thompson right into the end zone, 2 yards into the end zone. That's the block that got him in there. And when you're on the goal line and your offensive lineman is working on a guy in the end zone, you know you got a play working.
Here's Bergeron. Try for the extra point. He can make it 55-3 if he can get it, put it to the uprights. Decker waiting for the snap. Has it. Down. Kick is up. Kick is good. So Michigan leading now 55-3. With a minute and 59 seconds to go in the third quarter.
Take a look at the offensive line search on the touchdown. You see Michigan's off the ball. There is no penetration at all, only on the outside. Armstrong sees the hole, lowers his shoulders, both hands on the football, so there's no fumble. And there's 73 Doug James and 78 Hammerstein in the end zone as offensive linemen throwing blocks. Really controlling the offensive line of scrimmage.
All right, let's talk about something right now, Jim. Ohio State.
Well, I think what it does is it keeps your first-string guys fresh. The only thing I think that you have to work on is mentally preparing the kids, knowing that the next week won't be this same kind of game. You're going to have to fight for every inch. You won't break the big plays. That's what I think has to be done in this following week of preparation for Ohio State, is to know that every yard you get is going to be a tough one.
Johnson taking this one, and he picked it up and got it just across the 20-yard line. So 13 yards on the return. Michigan on that last drive going 75 yards in 9 plays, and well, let's see if they get tired this time.
I think they only got 4 of them over there, and they got to do 55 points. That would be 12 each. No, that'd be more than 12 each. 13? My addition.
I got 14.
14, okay. 14 times each. Don't have to do it a lot. Thank you, Bob.
Minute and 54 seconds to go in the third quarter.
I didn't major in math.
Turner on the carry. Gets up across the 25-yard line. Got close to 4 yards on the carry.
I majored in lunch when I was in school. Okay, let's get back to the game.
Tony Hunter, young man out of Memphis, we talked about earlier when he got on the ball game, and came in this game with a slight pulled hamstring. Built like a fire plug. Only 5'9", weighing 200 pounds. Now, he's a junior. So they do have some talent in their running backs. But a lot of them been hurt this year, as Jim told you. And Hunter trying to get outside this time. Uses a stiff arm, and he's effective with that on a couple of the defensive players of Michigan. And rolls close to the 27-yard line. And Dieter Hurin in there to push him out of bounds. Well, it's been all Michigan. What's the story about next week? We'll find out Saturday afternoon, of course. And then, of course, our telecast coming your way a week from tonight as the Ohio State Buckeyes move in Ann Arbor to take on the Wolverines in the finale of the regular season. Both teams looking for a bowl bid.
And a big bowl bid, and a major bowl will be at stake.
Third down and 5 yards for Minnesota. And look out. Fumble down there. Will they rule it dead? Or I think they will rule it dead right around the 20-yard line as Sadek was wrestled to the turf. Scarcelli. Jim Scarcelli.
Jim Scarcelli comes from the right side of your screen. The blocking back takes the blitzing man, Heron. Scarcelli comes free, knocks the ball loose, but Sadek does a real good job. He tries to get back to it, and then he gets an offensive guard back on the ball, Jeff Maritko, for the Golden Gophers. As Scarcelli getting one of the chances to play. He hasn't played a lot this year.
Adam Kelly gets another chance for a punt, and Gant has his second chance to take one. Exit at his 40, gets close to the 50-yard line. They'll mark it at the 49-yard line. A 40-yard punt that time by Adam Kelly. A 9-yard return by Gant. So another thing on these special teams, Bo and his staff getting a chance to use some other people out there in key positions, Gannon especially on a punt return.
And again, the experience, the game experience is extremely important. Michigan making more changes offensively. Jerry Quirna now at the quick tackle. Bob Papowski in there also at the quick guard position. Wideouts remain Gilvani Johnson and Steve Johnson.
All right, Gerald White is the tailback. Perriman, the fullback, they fake to it. Home on the option. Going straight ahead into Minnesota territory at the 45-yard line. That probably was the last play of the third quarter as the ball is marked at the 45 of Minnesota. And we'll check out a couple of stats on Minnesota right after we come back from a commercial message and get all set for the fourth quarter. After three quarters, Minnesota trailing Michigan 55-3. In the third quarter for Michigan, 131 yards. That's in the third quarter for Michigan alone on the ground, 13 yards in the air, 7 first downs. For Minnesota, catch this, no first downs in the third quarter. They have 1 in this ball game. A minus 3 yards in rushing for Minnesota in the third quarter, 9 yards in the passing department. Oh, my.
You aren't going to win many football games with those kinds of statistics. You've got to move the ball offensively, and I think Minnesota, you know, with Brett Sadek in there, quarterback, they're just totally, absolutely lost as far as what to do offensively against Michigan's defense. And Michigan's coming with a blitz and forcing them to do things they don't want to do.
All right, Michigan second and 5. Perriman on the carry. Might be shy of a first down, about a yard. So he picks up close to 4 yards and trying to get to the 40-yard line of Minnesota. They wrap him up just before he got to that stride. Might be close enough, however, for a measurement on a first down. And the officials will probably bring out the change. A solemn Minnesota side.
Well, you wonder what has to be going through the mind of Joe Salem. Maybe just let's get this over with. Not just this game, but the season.
Joe, of course, before coming to Minnesota, spent some time at South Dakota from 1966 to 1978, or rather 74. And then in 1975, moved on to Northern Arizona. You see the measurement now for that first down from Michigan. And then in 1979, arrived here at Minnesota. And really, after maybe the first season, things did not click here in the program as in dire straits.
You know, it's kind of an amazing thing. The defensive line, you talk about not giving up and how Minnesota hasn't given up all season long. The Gophers trailing 55-3, and one of their guys gets down on all fours and is checking that measurement out with a magnifying glass.
All right, Michigan, a third down efficiency, and they'll be in that situation right now. 6 of 11 in this ball game, and they need just about a foot for a first down. Just outside the 40-yard line of Minnesota. They start Armstrong in motion. Got Perriman the fullback. Perriman gets the call, has the first down, hits the 40-yard stripe, and his momentum should take him close to the 39-yard line of Minnesota. So Perriman getting the call. And he is the third fullback to be used by Bowe tonight. Started with Eddie Garrett, then Armstrong, and Bob Perriman. Been able to use Rick Rogers and Kerry Smith along with Gerald White in that tailback position. Marked at the 39-yard line, first and 10. 14 minutes and 24 seconds to go in this ball game. Michigan 55-3. The Wolverines led 41-3 after the first half. That's Hall at quarterback number 7. Steve Smith started and worked the early moments of the third quarter after starting the ball game. Gerald White on the call, and he cuts back in. He gets across the 35 to the 34-yard line and finally wrapped up over there. Slowly getting up for Minnesota, Duesbelbeck.
Running a sweep. They come with a blitz. Perriman covers the blitz man with a block. Good job by Gerald White cutting it back inside because there were so many people outside flowing to the football. On a play that they come with a blitz on it, Michigan picks it up with their blocking fullback, and the tailback cuts off that block back inside for decent yardage.
5 yards on the carry, second down and 5 for Michigan. And on the carry this time, number 38, Ben Logue. So Logue comes into the ball game and becomes the fourth tailback to work for Jim Buckner tonight. Sophomore out of Atlanta, Georgia. On his first carry of the evening, coming in the ball game, had carried a total of 9 times for 56 yards, so slightly better than 5 yards a carry.
And Gerald White coming in for Logue now, as Michigan using the tailbacks as their messenger guys.
Third down and 5. No gain on that last carry by Logue. So Michigan 7 of 12 in the third down conversions now. Here's Gerald White. Split wide to the left side. Perriman, the lone running back, in behind David Hall. Giovanni Johnson was out there in the open. And it was intended for heavy traffic for Steve Johnson. Kerry Glenn, the strong side safety, slipping in there. But he had the other Johnson player, Giovanni, on a little post pattern, who was the deeper man but didn't spot him.
He was open, too, right deep there. And again, it was Minnesota coming again with a delayed blitz. They sent some linebackers through there and had Hall look downfield a little bit further beyond Steve Johnson. He'd have seen Giovanni Johnson one-on-one coverage beating a defensive back in a post cut.
All right, we're going to get a 51-yard field goal effort now from Bob Bergeron. Larry Sweeney has checked in at center. Decker will hold the ball. And for Bergeron, should he be successful, this would be his longest of his career. He has a 45-yarder, don't forget, this year. The drill, has he got it? Yes, he has! 51 yards! The field goal by Bob Bergeron. So when things are going your way, smile. Okay, timeout. Fourth quarter with 12:39 to go. Michigan in a romp, 58-3. Well, Slopey will check in. Michigan on that last drive, going 60 yards in 6 plays. Slopey with the kickoff after Bergeron turned in his third field goal. This is the old Scribber taking around the 25-yard line. Wilson, Kevin Wilson, taking the ball, gets across the 35-yard line, piled up by Michigan defenders. So let's check out Mr. Bergeron's reaction on that last field goal.
51 yards, that's his longest. And I'll tell you what, Bob Bergeron is delighted. Talk about jumping for joy. I think that's it, all right?
Gotta be.
He must like the confines of this Metrodome up here in Houston. You know, in baseball season, they call it the Homer Dome. And it sure did all right by Bergeron, who drilled 151 yards for his 14th field goal of the season. And every time he kicks one, he breaks his own Michigan record.
Well, congratulations to our crew tonight, and congratulations on that last shot to get that reaction of Bergeron. First down and 10 at the 36-yard line from Minnesota. Sadek firing, and firing wildly that time to Hartwig. So it's been a poor night for Sadek, a quarterback. He is 3 of 16.
Michigan is really not doing anything to help Sadek either, because they're really coming right now with a three-man rush. The down three linemen, Hammerstein, Meredith, and Joe Gray, and they have eight men in the secondary in coverage. So it's tough to spot three or four receivers amidst eight white shirts out there.
Only 23 yards in the air by Minnesota. And Sadek has also thrown that one interception. Fullback is Wilson. Carries to the 40-yard line. So Minnesota, being down by a considerable margin, 58-3, not trying to do anything fancy and not rolling the dice here at all. And again, I'll sort of refer to what you did earlier, Jim. You go to the bench and you got to say, hey, you got to have heart to play this football game, no matter whether you're winning or losing. But when you're in a short end like this, you got to have lots of heart.
It is so frustrating, and you got to give these kids a lot of credit, because there haven't been any cheap shots. Minnesota's still out there playing, but they're not taking it out on anybody.
Sadek over the middle, rushed that time. That pocket just closing up on him. He wanted to go to McMullen coming over the top, and it was Scarcelli who was playing a pretty good ball game, coming in here and really coming in and causing the pressure.
Well, Scarcelli came over the top, and I think he hit Sadek's arm as he was coming through, and that forced the pass to go down into the ground. Of course, in a situation like that, you know that Minnesota is going to have to throw, so the defensive linemen and the defensive ends can tee off. They can line it up and get ready to come in a hard rush. And Minnesota just is not in a good position to do anything that's going to surprise Michigan.
Gant all set to take that punt coming in. Now they fake it, and they're going to pass it. And they do. And it's complete. Lott makes a play on Lungeon Howard.
Well, they
was mentioned from Detroit. We said they were not gambling. They're just sort of playing along, but they gambled that time and it paid off.
Exactly. And again, right after I said there's very little they can do to surprise Michigan, what do? Surprise Michigan.
Surprise the broadcast and telecast.
Absolutely. Well, Kelly, we didn't know that Kelly had that good an arm, but the thing about it was is that a receiver, Howard, was wide open. John Lott came over there after he saw Howard break out in kind of a pass pattern, but he was not anywhere near close enough to stop the pass from being completed.
We talked about earlier that definitely it has been Kelly, the big man tonight. Flag goes down, and our first penalty that we received, seen on a play tonight. We've seen a little bit of offside. But this one, a major penalty, as Fritz Burgess gets tangled up with the intended receiver over there and called for pass interference at the 11-yard line. Mark it at the 10-yard line of Michigan.
I think maybe, just maybe, Ray, the referees are feeling a bit sorry for the Gophers. That was a situation where the ball wasn't going to be completed. There was no chance for this pass to be complete because Sadek really threw it up under a blitz of Scarcelli again.
Yep.
See how short this ball is. And Burgess is just back there, backing up out of the way of the receiver. And the referee decided to throw the flag. I don't think necessarily that was a good interference call.
That was a third first down for Minnesota. First and 10 that time from the 11-yard line, from the 10-yard line, and on a carry. It was Tony Hunter. Hunter finally stopped after he got inside the 10 by Rich Hewlett, and they'll mark it at the 8-yard line. So a couple of yards on a carry. And for the Gopher cheering squad, something to cheer about. 8-yard line, second down. They've got to go to the one to get the first down. At the 7. Audible coming up this time from Sadek. And gets to his tailback. Little hole opened up and then closed up. And Tony Hunter squeezing to the 5-yard line. A gain of 2 on the carry.
You know, Hunter's impressive in that he gets to the hole, and after the first contact, he'll spin, and he'll make decent yardage afterwards. Now watch. He gets hit. There's the hit, and there's the spin. And he does a good job of running in there against some pretty tough, heavy traffic.
4 yards needed for the first down. Third down conversion here needed by Minnesota. Third, and as far as the third down conversions tonight, Minnesota 0-4-11. Rolling out of the pocket this time. Sadek has it flicked away. That time, one of the Michigan defenders coming in, and it was Scarcelli doing a job. Got the hand up and knocked it away.
It's a rollout pass. Scarcelli is keeping outside contained. He does not want the quarterback to get outside him. He sees him ready to throw, gets the hand up, and tips the ball away. That's a good technique by the defensive end. He's fighting to maintain outside position and not let the quarterback or anybody break contain outside. Then when he saw the pass coming, got his hands up and batted it down.
Well, the Gopher fans are pleased with the decision by Joe Salem to let his team try to go for the first down or for the touchdown here at the 5-yard line. They need four for the first down. Fourth and four. Sedek, fine, complete touchdown to Dwayne McMullen. So with 9 minutes and 37 seconds, Minnesota getting their first touchdown of this ball game. As McMullen on the receiving end.
Single coverage out here on the corner. They had the middle taken away, but McMullen ran a little flag pattern, faked inside, got Garland Rivers turned around, and then just backed up into the corner of the end zone, and Sadek threw a nice pass over there, but it was the move of McMullen that really got it going because he turned Garland Rivers around. They were taking away the inside pattern over the middle. They just turned it back outside, and Garland Rivers couldn't stay with him.
Jim Gallery tried for the extra point, and he's the all-time leader in extra points in Gopher history with a total of 94, trying to make it 95 career-wise, and does. So with 9:37 to go, Minnesota with a touchdown of the extra point, and Michigan on top now by a score of 58-10. Well, the place is jumping. A few moments ago, we were away for our commercial here with Minnesota getting a touchdown, that extra point to go with that field goal. And we might be looking for the onside kick here. Jim Gallery all set to kick it off. I got Kerry Smith and Rogers deep. Al Rogers, the only deep man back, standing around his 10-yard line. Smelling for the free kick. And Canis has it at the 43-yard line. And it is buried. But Eric Canis handles that one, and a good place to have your tight end with the good hands.
Well, Michigan had the anti-kangaroo kicker, anti-onside kick team out there, which is why Canis was in that position. Here's the touchdown again, and you see Sadek looking all the time out that way. The Michigan took the middle away from Minnesota, and when McMullen saw that, he made the inside move and turned Rivers around, then broke it back outside.
So for McMullen, his fourth of touchdown catch of the year. And Perriman on the carry that time as he took the handoff from Jim Harbaugh, who has checked in now at quarterback. So again, the luxury for Bo Schembechler to be able to have Smith, Hall, and Harbaugh all in one ballgame. So Harbaugh in his first play from the line of scrimmage. And on a carry by Perriman, got almost 9 yards. So it'll be second down and one. And Ben Logue checking in now to tailback position for Michigan. Harbaugh, number four. And behind him, Perriman, 37, Logue, 38. In the backfield. Audible coming up. And Logue on a carry, had a lot of daylight, was a little bit hesitant to stay outside. Has enough, plenty for the first down. In the Minnesota territory, right around the 43.
Well, you were right when you talked about a little bit hesitant. You'll see him going left, and there's a hole there, and Logue kind of stutter steps. He's waiting for the hole to develop. There it is. He should have made the move to it about another step earlier, and he might have been able to pop through on the other side. But he made the cut a little bit late and wasn't able to get in it and get any decent yardage. You get enough for the first down.
You see that ball marked at the 44-yard line of Minnesota. First and 10 for Michigan. Michigan leading 58-10 with 8:43 to go in this ball game. Harbaugh on the option, and he had a trailer in Gerald White, but he elected to carry the ball, and then was sort of stuffed by Willie Roller, the outside linebacker.
Well, on that play, Jim Harbaugh should have pitched it to Gerald White, and I think he just told White, "I'm sorry, I should have pitched it over there to you," because there were two people covering the quarterback. When the quarterback sees that happen, he's got to get that ball to the trailback or the pitchback, and there'd have been a lot of room for Gerald White around that corner.
Instead, a couple of yards lost by Harbaugh. So we go second down at 12.
Armstrong is checked in now at fullback. Wide receivers are on the left side. And split on the right side is Gerald White. Harbaugh out of the pocket, spots the man, and has a completion to Johnson. That's Steve Johnson.
Tries the lateral to Gilvani Johnson, who is picked off by Minnesota. Uh-oh, you're going to hear about that. Kerry Glenn picks it up. Well, Steve Johnson had the ball, then wanted a lateral to Gilvani.
I don't know whether he really wanted a lateral or whether he just got hit in the hands and the ball popped free in a fumble. Harbaugh does a good job getting away from pressure, then spotting Johnson. Now, here's the play.
Yep, no, you're right.
He just got the ball knocked free, and Kerry Glenn came up with it.
Yep, you're right. I saw Gilvani maybe four or five yards back to his left. We got a timeout right now. Michigan's still out in front, 58-10. Okay, turnover by the Wolverines. First and 10 now for Minnesota at the Gophers 25-yard line, and the Wolverines have called for a timeout. So with 7:48 to go, Michigan asking for a timeout. Maybe to get the forces going, or maybe it was just a little mix-up there, and maybe they were a man shy. We'll wait and see.
Well, I think if they didn't have the defense in there that they wanted, Keith Cowan, number 58, has come into the game at an outside linebacker position. And it looked like they only had 10 men on the field.
Yeah.
And that was why they called the timeout. In a situation like this, Ray, when you've got all the guys that you brought up to Minnesota playing, sometimes you're mixing second-team guys with first-team guys, third-team guys in there with the second-team guys, and you're not sure whether you're supposed to be in the game. So Cowan is at one outside backer, Scarcelli at the other backer. The inside linebackers are Reinhold and Moeller. The secondary, Cohen, Burgess, Rivers, and Rich Hewlett playing safety.
All right, Minnesota will try it now. First and 10 at the 25-yard line. 7:48 to go in the ball game. It's a 58-10 romp for Michigan. Sadek being chased, and wrapped up there in pretty good shape was the fellow that you were just talking about. Cowan just coming in and making the tackle.
Nobody blocked Cowan. Cowan started out to the bottom of your screen and on the wide receiver. Came in a blitz, and absolutely no one blocked him. And then Cowan does a good job as Sadek tries to turn it outside. And there you see Scarcelli in there, too. So they came with a double blitz from two outside guys. Cowan, one of them, Scarcelli, the other. And the Minnesota offensive line did not block that blitz on the corner.
Sophomore Keith Cowan, young man out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. So he gets a baptism under fire here on this road trip, 10th game of the year. Sadek firing, and Hartwick was out of bounds when he went up and grabbed that one. It'll be no catch.
And once again, Sadek under heavy, heavy pressure, that time by Joel Gray. Take a look at it. The offensive line of Minnesota is letting people through. Here comes Hammerstein, and Hammerstein is the guy that lays the wood on Sadek, and he just threw this out there under heavy pressure. And there you see it. He's got to get a foot down, and he doesn't. His left foot's out of bounds. He only needs one in college football. In professional football, you got to get both feet down. He was not knocked out of bounds, so the pass ruled incomplete.
Back at the 13-yard line now. Third down at 22. And Sadek rolling out, got away somehow. Running for desperation to the 30. To the 35, Millie had the first down and went out at the 36-yard line. First third down conversion tonight for the Golden Gophers.
And I'll tell you, this is all Sadek because Michigan comes again with a blitz. Moeller, 49, is coming. He almost gets to him. Joe Gray gets to him. He steps up in the pocket. He's got three or four people hanging around him. Gray is knocked down. Now Sadek turns upfield to run. He breaks the tackle of Scarcelli. Scarcelli overruns the ball. Now Sadek is into the secondary. Reinhold gets blocked over here by McMullen. And Sadek does a good job. He sees the first down yard marker. He gets to that. Now he steps out of bounds just out of the first down and avoids the hit by Cohen.
Fourth first down for Minnesota in this ball game. Watch the screen pass this time. And they complete it. And on the run is that little fire plug that we talked about. And that is Tony Hunter. So Hunter gets it across the 50 into Michigan territory, and a Michigan player is down. It looks like it's Andy Moeller.
No, it's Mike Reinhold down on the field injured. We have got a screen pass. You saw Michigan coming with a blitz.
Now, that is a situation where Michigan gambled and Minnesota caught them in the gamble, and they get the big play.
Mike Reinhold is the injured player. Sophomore out of Muskegon Catholic Central.
I think Mike has a serious knee injury or serious leg injury because they have immediately called for the golf cart. And I'm very much afraid that Mike Reinhold is gone for the season, and I think he's got a serious, serious knee injury.
Both training staffs, Michigan and Minnesota's training staff out there to help out on Reinhold.
See if we can see the injury. There's Reinhold. Ooh, he gets a shot on the side and a blind side below the waist, and it was the right knee. And that is a terrible-looking block right there. Holy cow, that... Yep. You don't like to see that at all.
So close medical attention being applied now to Reinhold. Really a lot of pain down there.
The thing that makes it even worse, I think, sometimes, Ray, is it's over. It's a 58-10 game, and Mike Reinhold in there playing, getting some experience, and he has to go down with a serious leg injury.
Okay, right now we've got a chance. Let's take a timeout.
Burger King.
Well, as you can see, a very serious injury for Mike Reinhold. He's been placed on a stretcher, and to our left, the ambulance has come to the edge of the football field, and they continue to work on Mike Reinhold right at the Minnesota bench. So we keep our fingers crossed. And one thing I did notice, Jim, some of the Minnesota players coming right over that stretcher, patting him, saying something to him. Back to the action now, first and 10 at the 49-yard line, Minnesota. At the Michigan 49. Sadek going deep and fires and had his tight end. Kevin Starks, and the tight end makes his first reception of this ball game. And he makes it inside the Michigan 15-yard line, run out of bounds at the 13.
Well, what happened was that Sadek broke contain, dropped straight back, and then rolled out. Hammerstein gets caught inside, and they're coming with a blitz as you see Moeller chasing, and then Sadek throws the pass, and it was single coverage in the secondary with Hewlett, the safety, on the tight end. Starks made the catch coming across the field in front.
Starks has been a reserve tight end until this week. Jay Carroll went down in that game. He was the first string tight end for Minnesota, and then went down in the Illinois ball game and was through for the year. So first and 10 now, and Sadek, looking around, decides that he wants to try to go to McMullen, and really didn't have a shot. Lott was over there. Meanwhile, Mike Reinhold being attended to and placed in that ambulance. So he will be on his way to one of the nearby Minneapolis hospitals.
I think the University of Minnesota has a hospital, but we're downtown here in the Metrodome. We're away from where the university complex is, but Mike Reinhold's right leg was injured, and it was in a splint, so there might be a break in there, along with some damage maybe to the knee and ankle. And we can only hope that it is better than we think it looked.
That's for sure. Second down, 10 at the 13. Screen pass comes out. And this time it's Tony Hunter. Hunter getting inside the 10-yard line, very close to the 5. And they had a pretty good wall in front of them that time.
Yes, they did. And again, Michigan comes with the big rush. And they're almost getting to Sadek. They're almost Hammerstein from the outside. Three people closing in on him. He gets the screen out. There are three linemen out in front. And Hunter does a good job following those guys to the furthest point he can get. Good decision by Hunter going to the sideline, because had he cut it back inside, he'd have run into some people.
Minnesota faced with a 3rd and 2 now at the 5-yard line. At 33 is Tony Hunter. Needed a couple of yards for that first down. Sadek rolling out, looking over the middle. Now he's going to carry and gets to the 4-yard line. And tripped up by Scarcelli. See where they place the ball down. If his knee hit at the 4, whether they'll give him to the 3. Close to the first down, however.
Well, Scarcelli again did a good job. We saw him earlier in the game prevent Sadek from getting outside and breaking contain. and then he knocked down the pass. This time we saw him get upfield, force Sadek back inside, and then react back into that and make the tackle, tripping him up. Good play by Jim Scarselli out there in that defensive end.
Not quite to the three-yard line. Minnesota faced with a fourth down and about a foot needed. They'll employ a double tight end. And Rob Pinkston has come into the other tight end. Kevin Starks. Fourth and a short one. Sadek on the keeper going straight ahead. And looks as if that he should have the first down. Slipping in there for that foot that he needed. In Michigan. Trying to bottle up things there if they could. And some of the Michigan players say no, they didn't make it. Meanwhile, the officials say we want to give a check. Maybe we'll have the chain gang come here. So far, they've not called for the chain. They're asking a lot. What do you think? Mott's going to say, let's make sure it's official. Let's bring in the chain.
A 58-10 game, do you think? Do you think maybe they need it?
Well, I'm thinking back about Michigan not giving a touchdown on the ground. You go back to that Wisconsin game. And they did not get it. So that defense of Michigan, and this is not the first line of defense either, but the reserves do the job of bobbling them up.
And it is a quarterback sneak, and Sadek jumps in there, and you can't see the progress of the ball, but the headlinesmen at either side come in and put their foot down. But you see Deep Felice and everybody, as soon as Sadek went on the sneak, they came in there and they pushed him back. And a lot of times in a situation like that, if it isn't absolutely sure by the view of the eyesight, you're at the luck of the draw in a sense of where the headlinesman spots the ball. That time Minnesota maybe didn't get the good spot, and Michigan takes over.
Perriman, and he gets some running room and gets a first down right around the 11-yard line. Coming in this ball game, while Jim was talking about the defense, against the rush first in the Big Ten, against the pass first.
And running behind the second team offensive line, Bob Perriman does a good job. The thing that he did that made the play go was he made a great cut at the line of scrimmage to get out of the way of a guy that had had penetration. And that was just a good run by Perriman, and he all ran over one of his own guys blocking downfield for him.
Mark it at the 17.
Well, Michigan is blessed with some very good running backs, fullbacks and tailbacks.
This time, the fullback on the carry. Perriman getting back up, and he works it for about 4 yards, so on his last two carries, he has not been too shabby at all. Second down at 6. 4-yard gain on that last carry by Perriman. Gerald White now in a tailback. Logue has gone out. Perriman stays in there. Giovanni Johnson and Steve Johnson, wide receivers on the right side. Second and 6. Harbaugh hand off to Gerald White. White for the first down. Close to the 30-yard line. White doing a good job of following a couple of his blockers.
And Gerald White goes out of the game now. He's limping and looks on the left leg. But again, you're right, Ray. Following his blockers. He sees the hole open up back inside. Makes the good cut and runs through two tackles. Now he's back outside. Both hands on the ball and rips through there. Good job of running and recognizing the hole. More than anything, recognizing the hole and getting into it.
As looks like he had gone back to the fence. Excuse me, Jim.
Looks like he had a little tender left ankle. Yeah.
Logue is in there, and Logue takes the pitch out for Harbaugh. 35, 40, down the sideline. A couple of players defeat and run out of bounds at the 49-yard line of Minnesota. So some crafty running turned in that time by young Mr. Logue.
Ben Logue had an incredible high school career down in Atlanta, Georgia, where he rushed for, I don't know, it seems like a million yards in his high school things. But the key to the play, the Perriman block, then Logue blinks inside, then back outside and uses his speed. Now here's where Perriman differs from some other scat backs. He lowers that inside shoulder and takes on a tackler. A lot of guys will just kind of run out of bounds in there, but Michigan's tailbacks for the most part are ripping up in there hard trying to make good yardage even when they see a guy coming.
Perriman that time on the plow and trying to get to the 45-yard line. The line of scrimmage was the 49 on the first and 10. Perriman
six carries now and close to 35 yards. White with four carries and 13 yards, and Logue three carries for a total of 25. This is on the backup guys that have come in here, especially in the fourth quarter. Second down and seven. Logan Perriman, the running back. And Harbaugh looking for somebody, looking for Gilvani Johnson. Throws a little bit behind him and underthrown at the 25-yard line. And covering on the plate for Minnesota was Larry Joyner, a linebacker.
Mark Schmerge in there at tight end also. He is the third tight end we've seen. Now Eric Kattis comes back in at tight end. Milt Carthen was lost to the Wolverines in last week's Purdue game.
Third down, seven, at the 46 of Minnesota. Our thanks again to Fred Poisson, who has been our spotter. Nice to have here in Minneapolis. Lowe, on a little delay, shy by a couple of yards of the first down, taking the handoff from Harbaugh.
Michigan going with the draw, Ray. 2:51 left to play in this football game. Michigan way out in front. 58-10, and Michigan going to the draw only because they're looking at a third down and long situation. A good call, you know. It's one of those things where if you make the first down and break it, you're a hero. If you don't, you're kind of a bum. But in a situation like this, with the score being what it is, so what?
That score, by the way, fans, 58-10, Michigan. Michigan led 41-3 at the half. So Brackett in there for the punt. Line of scrimmage is the 42. And sends a high, soft spiral at the 5-yard line. Bounces around, and Michigan will kill it right about the 5-yard line with 2:09 remaining. So Minnesota with a long way to go. And I guess you could say a long way to go in many aspects with their football program. In case you missed it, Illinois winning their ball game today. Ohio State and Iowa also winners. Wisconsin coming through with a victory. And Michigan chalking up their seventh win of conference play tonight. And that will set the stage for the showdown in Ann Arbor next week with the Buckeyes of Ohio State coming in to face the Wolverines of Michigan. And the gleam in both teams' eyes, those gleams are for bowl game.
And we hope you all join us for that one on the Wolverine Sports Television Network.
First and 10, just inside the 5-yard line of Minnesota. Gets it outside the 5, right around the 7-yard line. Well, this could be a very easy week for you at Michigan Replay.
Yeah, take a look at some of the other scores from around the country. Penn State, in a game that the team that scored last was the team that was going to win it. Penn State got in the last 11 seconds. Here's the big one for the Sugar Bowl. Georgia losing to Auburn. And then UCLA in the Rose Bowl gets their bid hurt quite a bit, losing to Larry Smith's Arizona Wildcats.
Second down, fumble back there, and Sadek recovers his own fumble and comes ahead and gets the first down at the 20-yard line.
Kind of like a flea flicker quarterback draw, except he bounced it. The old bounce pass. Take a look. He never got the snap of the ball. Pops right back up to him, and Michigan's reacting to the fumble. And Sadek goes right up the middle as Moeller came in to try to make the recovery on the fumble, and he ran right by Moeller because the ball bounced right straight back up to Sadek.
At the 21st and 10, Minnesota, down to 1:16 remaining this ball game. Michigan has been in command all the way, 58-10, the score at the present time. And they come with that screen pass again, and once again, one of the favorite targets that he uses for the reception is Donovan Small. First time that Donovan, however, has been on the receiving end of that screen pass.
We've seen Tony Hunter catch a couple of them, but it's the only successful play Minnesota's run. And again, it's been run in a situation where Michigan is coming with a big, heavy rush, trying to get to Sadek. A screen pass works in situations like that. He runs through the tackle by Cowan, then cuts back across against the grain, running to daylight, and then a good tackle by John Lott in the open field. He took the sideline away and forced Donovan Small to really go head up one-on-one with him.
So Gophers with a first down at the 32-yard line, their own 32, first and 10, down to 37 remaining in this ball game. Sadek going back looking for somebody, can't do it. He is brought down on another good defensive play by Michigan. And moving in on the stop that time, Mike Hammerstein. Don't forget, Mike got off to a very slow start this year because of that arm injury.
Brett Sadek is, you see that he's had a rough afternoon. His black jacket is black. All we can see. He's had a number. That black jacket has helped him, I'll tell you, this evening.
Down to 6 seconds. Not going to get it away. That's it. There is no more as time runs out. And the Gophers have played their final home game of the 1983 season here in Minneapolis. Meanwhile, it was a blowout. Michigan winning, final score, 58-10. We'll be right back.